so we will call the meeting, excuse me, call the meeting to order. This is the November 16th meeting of the Yellow Springs Village Council. Judy, would you please call the roll? And would everyone please turn their phones off? Thank you.
Winthrop.
Here.
Asland.
Yes.
Sims.
Here.
Pouch.
Here.
McQueen.
Here.
Also present are village manager Patty Bates and the village solicitor Chris Connor. Absent is assistant village manager Melissa Van Zandt, and I also see Chief of Police Dave Hale.
Any announcements?
I have two. First of all, we talked about at a prior meeting that we had to reschedule the VITA Village Inspiration and Design Award for Alan McBeth. And that has been scheduled for this Saturday, the 21st at 4 p.m. So you can go to Art and Soul and then you can come over and see Alan get his VITA award, which is already in place. We're gonna have a little reception at Alita's. It should be very nice.
Is that where it happened?
Yes, yeah, so we'll kind of be, you know, in the building. But yeah, we'll come to Alita's, that side. And secondly, I wanted to wish Patty good luck. She's heading out to San Diego really soon for her three-day, 60-mile walk to find a cure for breast cancer. You can still sponsor Patty if you haven't already. So it's always nice to do something that makes a difference. So, Patty, good luck.
Thank you. It's supposed to be really nice weather out there this weekend, and it'll be nice that I don't get rained on while I'm walking 60 miles, so it should be interesting.
And Karen, I want to...
Okay, go ahead. I have some too.
I think everybody knows that, you know, they've been having coffee with the police, the chief, and folks. Next Thursday, the chief has graciously accepted and is going to bring a couple of his officers. The group called Young People of Color are going to have a question and answer session with the chief next Thursday.
This Thursday?
Next Thursday.
Yeah. Do you know what date?
This coming Thursday.
The 19th.
The 19th.
Okay.
Yeah.
Where is that?
The 19th. It's going to be at the First Baptist Church, and it's open to all of the youth in Yellow Springs.
Okay.
And so we're expecting a big night, and the chief and his officers are also. So just want to let everybody know that it's open. So
at what time? What time is it?
It'll be at 7, I believe. Yes, 7 o'clock at the First Baptist Church.
Okay. Patty?
Just two quick announcements. First of all, Ruth Ann is collecting the names for the flour and sugar deliveries. So if you are eligible for that as a widow or widower, please contact Ruth Ann at my office. And also, Green County Solid Waste District and Green County Soil and Water Conservation District are sponsoring a tire amnesty event. So if you have any old tires that you need to get rid of, the information is on the bookcase outside my office down the hall.
Okay, and this Friday, the 20th, from 6 to 8, Yellow Springs High School is having a PBL project. It's a food expo. So the kids have been working since the beginning of the year on all kinds of projects related to food. They're actually going to have samples. So they're really encouraging the community to come and see the good work that they've been doing for the past few weeks. Then Brian mentioned Art and Soul. Art and Soul is an art fair that will be at Mills Lawn on Saturday the 21st from 10 to 5. And remember to support your local businesses and shop local on Yellow Friday and Small Business Saturday. That's the Friday after Thanksgiving and Saturday after Thanksgiving. Anybody else? Commercial time. Okay. The consent agenda includes the minutes of the past two meetings, the October 19th work session and the November 2nd regular meeting. Do I have a motion to accept? Motion?
I move.
Second.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
I have to stay aye.
Can we do that, Chris?
If they weren't there, they can't vote to approve.
I know, but so can we do that as a consent agenda and have two people abstaining?
Never mind, I was there. I was there for all of them.
It's okay, okay.
So I do approve them.
Okay, let's move on, so I think we approved, in percent, it's okay. Moving on.
I was gone for one more.
Yeah, you.
I'm sure I missed one of those.
I thought you did, yeah.
Can we just get three of them to move to approve and pass? Because it's a quorum anyway, and then it makes it much easier.
Okay, so all those in favor, signify by saying aye.
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 Abstentions?
Aye.
Thank you. Next is a review of the agenda, to see what's on the agenda and see if there's anything that we would like to move. I would actually like to suggest that we move up the resolution 2015-51, appreciating President Mark Roosevelt's contributions, as I see he's here. And he has his arm bandaged and probably would like to leave as quickly as possible.
He wants to sit through it.
Come on up, Frank.
Thank you, I appreciate it.
Electronic emergency.
Yes.
So is that okay with everybody? Okay, anything else that we want to move or add or change on the agenda? Okay. Lori, are you ready to review the petitions and communications?
Well, most of them had to do with the ACE task force discussion. And you know what, I read them all, but I did forget to detail them. So let me jump down, now that I got my phone, my machine plugged in. We have Kristen Skaggs, who is opposed to leaving the task force. We have Marianne McQueen's letter asking us to leave the task force. Judith Hempling's letter supporting leaving the task force. In a very long, really nice autobiography from one of our officers, whose name is Jeff DePauli, so supporting the work of the task force and sort of explaining why he sees it as as important work. Isaac, and I apologize if I'm mispronouncing names, Isaac De La Mater is saying supporting leaving the task force. And Chief wrote a long piece on explaining why he believes the supporting the task force is still a good thing to do. And Carter Collins wrote asking us to leave the task force. Yolanda Simpson wrote in mostly asking us to answer a lot of questions and to think about the issues of how this affects us locally, that the meetings have been on a very high level of policy, and she was wanting us to ask questions like what would happen if we're not part of the task force, and if we remain on the task force, what can we do to address the concerns that people have about the task force. So she was more asking, I think, very useful questions. And the Aaron Burke expressing a strong desire to disengage with the task force, and Al Schlieder asking us to stop supporting the task force. And I believe those are all the task force letters, if I'm correct. I hope I didn't miss any.
You got them all.
Okay. And Patty, it gave us some information about radio frequency safety based on a discussion that came up at last meeting, and also some information about exactly what the Greene County Jail and Drug Treatment Center that people people have expressed concerns about with regard to the task force. Les Groby online sent us some links regarding especially civil forfeiture and expressing concern about the morality of civil forfeiture. And those are all the letters from citizens.
Thank you.
Sorry, I'm usually a little more organized than that.
A lot. So let's move on to public hearings and legislation. As I said, we'll, the first one we'll do is resolution, and I will actually read this in full, and I would like to read this myself, if that's okay with everyone. So this is resolution 2015-51, appreciation of Mark Roosevelt and furtherance of Antioch College. Whereas Village Council desires to recognize President Mark Roosevelt for 5 years of exemplary service to Antioch College and the entire community, and whereas Village Council wishes to congratulate President Roosevelt for many outstanding achievements during his tenure, including the growth of the college from 35 students to 300 students, beginning fast-track accreditation with the Higher Learning Commission, sustained growth in the college's fundraising efforts, achieving true independence for the institution, development of a rigorous curriculum and applied liberal arts, investment in the redevelopment of campus infrastructure and facilities, articulating a vision for the future with a strategic plan to take it there. And whereas President Roosevelt prioritized deepening the relationship between Antioch College and the Village of Yellow Springs, recognizing that the future of both are strongly connected, cementing that relationship by focusing on the shared priorities of sustainability, the arts and wellness, renovating significant facilities for shared use of the community and college, including the Wellness Center, Foundry Theater, Herndon Gallery, and the Corette Scott King Center, developing a sustainable campus infrastructure, utilizing energy efficiency and alternative energy in the form of geothermal and solar, and whereas President Roosevelt set the Antioch College Village into motion, outlining an exciting multi-generational housing project that will attract alums, professors, and staff, young families and retirees looking to live in an education village where lifelong learning is the goal, thereby increasing the population of Yellow Springs, the number of students in our schools, the number of customers for our businesses, and the number of individuals committed to the values that make Yellow Springs so special. Now, therefore, be it resolved by the Council of the Village of Yellow Springs, Ohio, that Section 1, Thursday, December 3rd, 2015, is hereby dedicated to President Mark President Mark Roosevelt Day in Yellow Springs. Section 2, this resolution shall go into effect at the earliest period allowed by law. Can I have a motion?
So moved. Second.
Thank you. Mr. President Roosevelt, I would like to present this to you. Thank you.
You want me to say something and then you decide if you're
going to. Yeah.
Well, I will be very brief, which hopefully will get some favor from you. First of all, I want to thank you very much. I want to thank the village very much. I want to thank Diane very much. It's hard to remember back to 5 years ago. Things were hard. There was a lot of animosity. There was a lot of discord. And people were not committed necessarily to putting the enterprise and its success above the many dissensions that existed in the community that were very understandable. A lot of people had been hurt by a lot of things that had happened. But for whatever reason, people have been willing to come together. So that is one thing I'm very, very grateful for. My first year was brutal. My second year was by Etter. My third year was a much better, fourth and fifth better. My last would just be a request. Antioch's going to be a small college. It is a small college. It's got small resources. It wants to continue to serve primarily students who deserve to go there on their merits rather than on their families' pocketbooks, which means it's got a hard road to hoe. Integration with the village is an essential component in college figuring out a sustainable plan for the future. The one thing you didn't mention out of your very kind list, Karen, at least I did not hear it, you may have mentioned it, was the event that we had last weekend, placing the Glen in protection for perpetuity. The college did not need to do that. The college could have monetized a percentage of the Glen, probably to double or even triple our endowment. It would have been possible. It wouldn't have been the right thing to do. It would have pitted village concerns against the college. It would have pitted a lot of alumni against the college. But I just hope when things come along, and you all have been very generous with the issues around the solar panel, but when things do come along that require some flexibility on the college, on the village's part towards the college, I hope we can continue in that spirit. And then lastly, I promise, I hope we continue to think big. You know, we all get stuck in past patterns, but when you look ahead, the college's farm and the letter from Isaac Delatra, you know, who's our chef, the college dreams of being able to provide the food to the Yellow Springs Public School System, for example, to have the kind of partnership that would upgrade significantly the quality of the food that's being served there, and also show how we can work better together. The Antioch College Village and other initiatives present the opportunity, just as an example, perhaps, to work with Honda, which has a huge plant in Ohio, to somehow incentivize Yellow Springs to be the electric car capital of America. The limits of what we can do together are only the limits of our imagination. Both institutions are so much stronger when coupled together, working towards this goal. And again, it's already a unique village. You guys know that. Living here 5 years, boy, do I know that. It's already a unique college. But by bringing them closer together around shared objectives, they can show an example to the nation of how a small residential liberal arts college without that much money, and a town that, though not rich in resources, is rich in imagination, can form a partnership to the benefit of both. So thank you very much for your recognition of me. The new president will be introduced at the end of this week. I hope that they get the same kind of support that I have been privileged to receive from you. So, much appreciated.
Thank you very much. So what do we think? Should we take a vote? All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Thank you so much, Mayor.
Thank you. Reggie Stratton, by the way. You all know Reggie Stratton?
Really?
No.
I thought maybe he tripped you.
No, no. His bat was on the tennis court. Sorry not to stay. I'll bet you again.
Thank you. Feel better. Okay, now we'll get back to the regular part of the agenda. Second reading and public hearing of Ordinance 2015-19. I am suggesting, since we have copious pieces of legislation, that as we have been, that we hear them all by title only.
Works for me. Adopting Chapter 881 of the Codified Ordinances of the Village of Yellow Springs regarding municipal income tax, effective January 1, 2016.
Can I have a motion, please?
Second.
Okay, so this is the ordinance that is required by the new House Bill 5. Its language has been recommended by Rita and the Ohio Municipal League that we add. The specifics, Chris, or do you know the specifics of Chris?
Well, I can, if you want to, or I can.
Just take a moment to...
Sure. The Ohio legislature passed legislation that requires all municipalities to adopt these new requirements, new laws, effective January 1st. The village is a member of the Regional Income Tax Administrators Association. RITA drafted model legislation, which we tailored to fit the village's needs, following extensive review and revisions with Patty's input and Melissa's input. What you have before you is the final version that we believe reflects what the law requires us to do.
Thank you. Any comments or questions from council? This is a second reading, and I will open the public hearing for comments from citizens, questions. Seeing and hearing none, I'll bring it back to the council table. Judy, would you please call the roll?
Yes. Asplund.
Yeah.
Hausch.
Yes.
Sims?
Yes.
Sweeney?
Yes.
Petro?
Yes. Next is ordinance 2015-20.
All right, this is an ordinance repealing old Chapter 288, Public Art Commission of Title VIII, Boards and Commissions of Part II, Administration Code of the Codified Ordinances of the Village of Yellow Springs, Ohio, and enacting new Chapter 288, Arts and Culture Commission.
Can I get a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
Okay, so we heard these, we actually talked extensively about these at the last meeting. The purpose of this is to normalize and get the same language and the same process and procedures for all of our commissions, all of the commissions and boards of council. The changes that were made at the last meeting have been integrated. There were a couple of language changes made to all of them, in fact. Any other comments or questions from council members on this? This is a second reading, so I will open the public hearing for public comment. Seeing and hearing none, I'll bring it back to the table. Please call the roll.
Yes, Hausch?
Yes.
Sims?
Yes.
McQueen?
Yes.
Asbell?
Yes.
Winthrop?
Yes. 2015-21.
Oh, heavens.
It's community access now.
Yeah, no, I've got them somehow way out of whack here.
It's the same title, but with community access in it.
It's the same chapter.
Yeah.
Repealing old Chapter 280, Community Access Panel of Title VIII Boards and Commissions of Part II, Administration Code of the Codified Ordinances of the Village of Yellow Springs, Ohio, and enacting new Chapter 280, Community Access Panel. Can I get a motion?
So moved.
Second.
Same thing here. This just happens to be for Community Access Panel. Questions, comments, council? This is a second reading. I will open the public hearing for comments or questions from citizens. Seeing and hearing none, I'll bring it back to council table. Judy?
McQueen?
Yes.
Hausch?
Yes.
Sims?
Yes.
Asbell?
Yes.
Winthrop?
Yes.
And ordinance 2015-22, repealing old Chapter 284, Economic Sustainability Commission of Title VIII, Boards and Commissions of Part II, Administration Code of the Codified Ordinances of the Village of Yellow Springs, Ohio, and enacting new Chapter 284, Economic Sustainability Commission.
Can I get a motion?
Second.
Okay, same thing for the Economic Sustainability Commission. Council, I'll open the public hearing for any public comments. Seeing and hearing none, I'll bring it back to the table for a vote.
Okay, Asbell?
Yes.
McQueen?
Yes.
Sims?
Yes.
Hausch?
Yes.
Winthrop?
Yes.
Okay. 2015-23 is repealing old Chapter 286, Energy Board of Title VIII, Boards and Commissions of Part II, Administration Code of the Codified Ordinances of the Village of Yellow Springs, Ohio, and enacting new Chapter 286, Energy Board.
Thank you. Can I get a motion?
So moved.
Second.
And this is the same thing for the Energy Board, Council. Okay, I will open the public hearing for comments. Seeing none, I'll bring it back to Council table for a vote.
Hausch?
Yes.
Asbell?
Yes.
Sims?
Yes.
McQueen?
Yes.
Winthrop?
Yes.
Ordinance 2015-24 is repealing old Chapter 278, Library Commission of Title VIII, Boards and Commissions of Part II, Administration Code of the Codified Ordinances of Village of Yellow Springs, Ohio, and enacting new Chapter 278, Library Commission.
Thank you. Can I get a motion?
So moved.
Second.
Oh.
Same thing for the Library Commission. Council, I'll open the public hearing for comment. Seeing and hearing none, I'll bring it back to council table for a vote.
Sims?
Yes.
Asbell?
Yes.
McQueen?
Yes.
Hausch?
Yes.
Winthrop?
Yes.
Ordinance 2015-25 is repealing old Chapter 276, Human Relations Commission of Title VIII, Boards and Commissions of Part II, Administration Code of Codified Ordinances of the Village of Yellow Springs, Ohio, and enacting new Chapter 276, Human Relations Commission.
Thank you. A motion, please.
So moved.
Second.
This is the same legislation for the Human Relations Commission. Any comments or questions from citizens? Or I'll open the public hearing for comments or questions. Seeing and hearing none, I'll bring it back to the table for a vote.
Asbell?
Yes.
Hausch?
Yes.
McQueen.
Yes.
Sims.
Yes.
Woodrow.
Yes. Okay, last one of these.
Yay. 2015-26 is repealing old chapter 274, Environmental Commission of Title 8, Boards and Commissions of Part 2, Administration Code of the Codified Ordinances of the Village of Yellow Springs, Ohio, and enacting new chapter 274, Environmental Commission.
Can I get a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
So this is the last one of our boards and commissions that are getting this new language. This is Environmental Commission. Comments or questions from council? Open the public hearing for questions or comments from citizens. Seeing and hearing none, I'll bring it back to council table for a vote.
McQueen.
Yes.
Hausch.
Yes.
Sims.
Yes.
Asplund.
Yes.
Woodrow.
Yes. Oh, glad to have that done. I think that was, yes, that was how many, a lot of years of work actually, and thanks to Brian and Mary Ann for finally pulling it all together. Next we have first reading of ordinance 2015-27.
And then do you want this by title only?
We should probably read the numbers.
Okay.
Let's read the totals.
The highlights, yeah.
The totals, yeah. Yeah.
Okay, so this is the 2016 annual appropriations and declaring an emergency. Whereas this ordinance is adopted to make appropriations for expenses and other expenditures of the Village of Yellow Springs, State of Ohio during the fiscal year ending December 31, 2016. Now therefore the Council for the Village of Yellow Springs, Ohio hereby ordains that. Section 1, to provide for expenses and other expenditures of the said Village of Yellow Springs during the fiscal year ending December 31, 2016. The following sums are hereby set aside and appropriated as follows. Section 2, that the reappropriated from the general fund, the total general fund appropriation will be $3,306,664. Section 3, that it be appropriated from the following special revenue funds, and that total is $1,328,730. Section 4, that there be appropriated from the capital project funds, and that total is $42,100. Section 5, that there be appropriated from the enterprise funds, that total is $6,428,322. Section 6, that the appropriation from the total fund budget is as follows. This is the grand total appropriations for all funds, $11,105,816. Section 7, the finance director and the village manager are hereby authorized to draw warrants on the village treasury for payments from any of the foregoing appropriations upon receiving proper certificates and vouchers, therefore approved by an ordinance of council to make the expenditures, provided that no warrants shall be drawn or paid for salaries or wages except to persons employed by authority of and in accordance with such ordinance. Section 8, this ordinance shall take effect at the earliest period allowed by law. Section 9, this ordinance is hereby declared to be an emergency measure immediately necessary to preserve public interest and for the health, safety, and welfare of the citizens of the village. Wherefore, this ordinance shall be in effect immediately upon its adoption by council.
Thank you. Can I have a motion for this?
I move.
Second.
Okay. I want to address the emergency language to start with. We will be doing two readings of this ordinance. The emergency language will just allow it to go into effect before the first of the year. So since it's our 2016 budget, it's probably a good idea. Patty, do you want to, without Melissa here, I guess it falls to you.
Yes, this is the budget that was discussed by council at, I believe, three or four different meetings. The various funds, general fund, special revenue, enterprise, capital, it incorporates all of the changes and all of the projects that council wanted included, and it is the total budget for 2016.
And the rest of the budget, all the documents are still available online.
That, absolutely.
People wanted to look at this. This is really just the bare bones version of it.
Yeah, that's the only thing I would say from now on, to make sure we include the few pages of. I would have liked to have had the explanation documents. So for the next reading, just include those.
I agree for the second reading.
Any other comments or questions from council?
Well, I think that we really did a good job with this and actually getting it done even before the end of the year. Is that, that's sort of unusual.
Well, yeah.
We've gotten certainly better. Melissa's really helped us in a lot of ways get things done faster, and I think it's been a council priority to not be doing this in the beginning of the year.
Right, and I think we, at a point we had, when there was an election year, we said, oh, well, let's put it off because new council members can't possibly be up to speed on the budget. I think this, we've just decided that's just not a responsible approach. And I think that that's also one of the reasons why the change in the charter that has the new council members not taking office until the 1st of January makes some sense, because it does allow the council that developed the budget to vote on it and see it, and see it to completion.
And people should be aware that this is just the budget that we approve now. If a new council member has, you know, wants different priorities or wants, they can make the case, right? And so it's an ordinance, but ordinances are made by council, and council can always make other decisions. But it's really good to have it in place before the first of the year. We used to push it to where it was almost April by the time the absolute last deadline that we could get in, which wasn't really a good
idea. Not a good idea, no. So we don't need to have an official public hearing, but I don't think there's ever been so many people here when we actually voted on the budget ordinance. So does anybody have any questions or comments? Okay. So Judy, would you please call the vote?
Yes. Sims?
Yes.
Hausch?
Yes.
Asplund?
Yes.
McQueen?
Yes.
Winthrop?
Yes. Okay, the next is 2015-28.
This is repealing old section 1282.05, non-conforming lots of record of chapter 1282, non-conforming uses, buildings and lots of Title IV, zoning of Part 12, planning and zoning of codified ordinances of the Village of Yellow Springs, Ohio, and enacting new section 1282.05, non-conforming lots of record.
Can I have a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
So Patty, will you take this on, or should somebody from planning?
I can, unless Lori or Jerry would like to.
Go ahead.
The section in the zoning code on non-conforming lots did not allow you to combine adjacent non-conforming lots, contiguous lots that are owned by the same owner. Essentially what this does is allows the owner, if you own two contiguous lots to one deed, they can be considered one lot for the purposes of the zoning code, which essentially eliminates the non-existent interior lot line that could many times limit what someone could do on their property.
It gives more flexibility and allows people who own these weird lots that don't fit with what we say a lot has to be now to do what they want to do without having to spend lots of money on lawyers and getting lots of documents through.
Any other comments or questions from council? Citizens, comments or questions? Judy, would you please call the vote?
Yes. McQueen?
Yes.
Asplund?
Yes.
Sims?
Yes.
Hausch?
Yes.
Winthrop?
Yes. 2015-29.
This is repealing old section 1260.04, uses of chapter 1260, general provisions of Title IV zoning of Part 12, planning and zoning, of the codified ordinances of the Village of Yellow Springs, Ohio, and enacting new section 1260.04 uses.
Can I have a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
Okay. Patty?
This amendment to the zoning code has to do with the total amount of square feet that a person can have in an accessory structure on their lot. I believe this one also addresses driveway setbacks. So essentially what this does is it makes it a little bit easier for a person to put an accessory structure on their lot that they can use for various purposes as limited by the square footage of the principal structure or by the available yard space in the rear yard.
Comments, questions? Comments or questions from citizens? Seeing and hearing none, I'll bring it back to table for a vote.
Hausch?
Yes.
McQueen?
Yes.
Sims?
Yes.
Asplund?
Yes.
Winthrop?
Yes. This is 2015-30.
This is repealing old section 1266.05, permitted signs of chapter 1266, signs of Title IV zoning of Part 12, planning and zoning of the codified ordinances of the Village of Yellow Springs, Ohio, and enacting new section 1266.05, permitted signs.
Can I get a motion?
So moved.
Second.
Patty?
It's my understanding that this does not change any of the requirements or allowances for signs. It simply cleans up the language and the structure of this section to make it a little bit easier to interpret.
Yes, it's a lot easier to read and understand.
Okay. Can I ask a question about one of them, though? Type D, the development sign, it seems it's specifically talking about subdivision development. Is there a reason that wouldn't be applicable to commercial development? It's basically a job sign, a 4x8 job sign.
I don't see why it wouldn't. Lori, Jerry, do you have?
No, I don't think the question came up.
I mean, so it seems like maybe the language change would just be from the date of the subdivision, record plan, whatever.
Right.
Some language, and maybe staff can come up with that.
It would be a development sign.
This is the first reading?
Yeah.
So we can
make that change.
Make that change, and then if there's some reason that staff feels that it would be a problem, I can't imagine what.
I had a question. For residential signs, I don't see what the setback is. So where it says location, so it's under A, location, it gives for conservation, industrial, and other. Is residential considered other, or?
Yeah, it does have, it does seem to be missing that.
I mean, I think it is 10 feet. I think maybe it's just missing.
Right.
It's not.
All right.
So just check on that one. Anything else? Comments or comments or questions from citizens before we take the vote? Okay. Judy, would you please call the roll?
Yes. Sims?
Yes.
Ouch?
Yes.
Asley?
Yes.
McQueen?
Yes.
Winthrop?
Yes. 2015-31.
Oh, not again.
Sorry.
There we go. This is repealing old section 1262.08, specific requirements of chapter 1262, conditional use requirements of Title IV, zoning of Part 12, planning and zoning of the codified ordinances of the Village of Yellow Springs, Ohio, and enacting new section 1262.08, specific requirements.
Can I get a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
Hey, Patty.
This was simply what we believe was an oversight for allowing conditional uses in the RC zone. The code allowed for conditional uses in RA and RB, but not in RC, and we believe that was just an oversight. So this simply adds the RC zone for conditional uses.
So all of these pages were, that was the only
that
change?
Was it.
Yeah, I was looking through this whole thing, yep. Trying to figure out, okay, where's
yeah.
the change?
No, that was
just
it.
Adding
that
RC, one tiny little thing.
Yep.
Yeah. Yeah.
Any, yes, I have a comment. Question. So we approved a change in ordinance 2015-31 that changed, the one that changed the size of accessory structures from, I think, a potential from 50% of the primary to 60. Or a total of 800 square feet, which is
66,
smaller.
Yeah, 66.
But in this, the ordinance that we're considering right now, it lists accessory dwelling units as being 50% of the primary dwelling or 750. So I guess my question is this going to change along with the general change?
And Lori, correct me if I'm wrong, but the zoning code addresses accessory dwelling units
yeah.
differently than it does other accessory structures.
So it was the intention of Planning Commission to leave these numbers the same for the accessory dwelling units?
I believe
and
so.
I guess if it was, I'm asking why.
Well, we didn't talk about it at this time, but we talked about it when we passed it originally. And
I mean, I guess what would be the rationale for allowing accessory units to be larger, but not allowing accessory dwelling units?
Right.
To be so, I mean, do you think it's just an omission?
We didn't talk about it, so it's hard for me to say. We changed that. The other one.
The other one, was sort of partly changed because of the setbacks.
Yeah, it was mainly that.
But at the same time, you enlarged the potential.
And honestly, I missed a bunch of, I had to miss some meetings when we were just, but I'm sorry, I don't have my notes, so I can't really review them and for some reason.
It seems that it's something that staff should go back and look at the minutes.
Yeah.
And consult and decide if we need to make that change, then we can make that change to the next reading.
Yeah, I'm glad you caught that.
I'm glad you caught, yeah, it could.
I just read right over the numbers.
So Patty will come back at the next meeting with an explanation, either that it should be changed or why it wasn't changed.
Yeah, I would say we should make it consistent. If there's no good reason for it, let's just make it consistent with the other one. So I'm glad you caught it.
Well, can we do that?
Well, no, Patty needs to check.
Just make sure that there wasn't.
Understand if there was a reason.
Yeah. I can't imagine there was, but I don't want to speak without having double checked the minutes and refreshing my memory.
Anything else?
Well, I guess I would like to see a change, so I'm not sure whether I would vote to approve this.
But I think what we're saying is that if staff, if there isn't a reason for it, I think what we're saying is we agree that it should be changed unless Planning Commission intentionally left it like that. And I think it would require further discussion, and that we will have that discussion at the next meeting.
Maybe we should just table this and then.
Or we don't have to take a vote, right?
Well, yeah, that's true. We don't have to take a vote. So let's not take a vote on this one. Patty will come back with explanation for the next meeting and either a changed ordinance or changed language or a reason as to why it stays the same. Okay. Any other comments or questions from council? Comments or questions from citizens before we move on about that particular ordinance? Okay. Next, we have resolution 2015-49.
This is the official question and issue ballot, general election, March 15, 2016, proposed tax levy renewal.
Can I get a motion, please?
Second.
So this legislation basically lays out what we're asking, the renewal of the levy. This will be the third renewal of an 8.4 mil property tax levy provides about $770,000 into the general fund budget. It actually lays out what the question is, the ballot language. Is this the last piece of legislation we'll have related to the levy, or will there be more? One more?
No, there are two.
Okay. So.
You have section one. Council's received certification issued by the county auditor, which we have this morning.
So this has been certified,
yes.
Okay.
Yes.
So the county auditor has blessed our request for this property tax on the ballot. Any other comments or questions? Patty, do you have anything to add?
I think there's one more piece of legislation after this.
We'll deal with it when we get at
this. This is strictly a renewal. This is what keeps the general fund above water. So it's nothing, there's no increase, there's no additional tax. It's a straight renewal.
And this would be on March 15th.
It would be in March, yes. That's when the primary election is in 2016.
And we're under a pretty tight time, a pretty specific timetable to get this all in to meet the election requirements. Any comments or questions from council? Comments or questions from citizens? Seeing and hearing none, all those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
I think this is the last piece of legislation, 2015-50.
Right, this is adopting a vision for policing policy in Yellow Springs.
Let's go ahead and read this in full.
Sure. Whereas the Village of Yellow Springs prides itself on having a police department that respectfully serves our community, directly responds to the needs of citizens, and actively ensures the safety of residents and visitors. And whereas this is accomplished through adherence to principles and practices developed through collaboration among council, the village manager, the chief of police, staff, and citizens,
And whereas collaboration has been provided for and encouraged by council with resulting information used to develop the policing policy vision attached as Exhibit A. Now therefore, the Council for the Village of Yellow Springs, Ohio hereby resolves that. Section 1. Council for the Village of Yellow Springs hereby accepts the attached policing policy vision as a guiding principle used by the village manager and chief of police in developing and carrying out policing policies. Section 2. Council hereby certifies that support of this vision is in accordance with village goals regarding provision of a welcoming community that serves and protects people of diverse races, ages, sexual orientations, cultures, and incomes.
Thank you. Can I have a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
Brian and Mary Ann, I will ask one of you to add anything to this that was developed, I think, between you and the chief.
Well, it seemed that after the forums the HRC had on local policing and after council discussed what it was that we wanted our police department to uphold, that it made sense to have some kind of document that stated that. And so the document that we came up with seemed to capture as well as we could what we felt like the majority of the community was saying, and we did that, as Karen said, in consultation with Chief Hale and Patty Bates, and council has looked at it as well.
Well, the only thing I'll say is this has been a part of our process in terms of how we're going to start making decisions, which is obviously why most people are here tonight, as well as our involvement with the ACE Task Force. And then we've talked about at the turn of the year, looking at how do we maximize the benefits of Mayor's Court and so forth. So I think it was important to council that we formalized what these vision and values that underlie that look like.
Thank you. comments or questions from citizens?
Are you going to read those so we can work with them? You mind reading it, Judy?
The entire document?
Yeah, it's, you know, just one page.
Here we go.
Are there copies out on the hall table?
There were, yes.
Okay.
The Village of Yellow Springs will have a police department that provides a safe and welcoming environment for those who live, work, and use it, and that respects the rights of all individuals and recognizes the community values of inclusion, responsibility, and compassion. The Village of Yellow Springs prides itself on having a police department that respectfully serves our community, directly responds to the needs of citizens, and actively ensures the safety of residents and visitors. This is accomplished through adherence to the following principles and practices. Safety-centered. Safety is the primary need identified by Yellow Springs citizens with regard to police services. Most community members feel that Yellow Springs is a safe community, which is facilitated by cooperation among residents, officers, and other community members. The YSPD supports safety in our village by being proactive and seeing that as much as possible, unsafe situations do not occur. For example, a police car stationed on Zena Avenue can remind motorists to obey the speed limit as opposed to setting up a speed trap situation. Friendly police presence around town can have the same effect, and it is important that officers are known and respected by community members. This highlights the need for many and varied opportunities for officers to meet people formally and informally. Other ways the YSPD meets our needs for safety include helping elderly or disabled individuals, responding quickly to medical emergencies and traffic accidents, and defusing potentially violent situations. The community expects the YSPD to deal effectively with criminal activity, yet because the rate of actual crime in Yellow Springs is low, it is these more everyday activities that impact how the community sees and responds to the police. Support oriented. When our police officer must interrupt unlawful behavior, the community expects that they will act with compassion, flexibility, and reasonableness, treating everyone fairly and consistently. This means, for example, that a person's appearance or ethnicity should not affect how an officer treats the person. A key success factor in developing this attitude and approach is excellence in training and solid leadership. Citizen focus. Mutual respect is critical to engendering a sense of safety for all residents and visitors of Yellow Springs, which underscores the importance of appreciating the diversity of the individuals who live and interact in our village. Officers should engage with different stakeholders such as youth, business owners, educational organizations, and families, as well as with groups promoting social justice and equality and human rights to establish relationships, exchange ideas, initiate projects, and create learning opportunities.
For those collaborative relationships to be successful, the YSPP needs to attract and retain people who are open and excited about engaging in this way. Locally minded, the Village of Yellow Springs actively promotes long-term investment and participation in our community by our police officers. Exposure to local culture and events is critical as developing relationships between citizens and officers encourages dedication to and longevity with the village. It is important that YSPD team members are a part of our community and feel connected, and the village needs to facilitate this. Yellow Springs Village Council will use this vision for local policing to guide policy decisions that are aligned with community values and support best practices in the Yellow Springs Police Department.
Thank you. Comments or questions? Seeing and hearing none, I will, all those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Okay, that was a lot of legislation. Next item on the agenda is citizens' concerns, and that is for items that are not on the agenda. Each person has 3 minutes. We ask that you come to the podium and state your name. Okay, doesn't look like we have any. Excuse me, hold on, sir.
This is really hard for me to do, but I've lived here for 23 years. Never really got in any trouble except for juvenile crap, you know, with Grody.
Could you state your name? I'm sorry.
My name's Jasmine McCoy. I've never done this before.
Oh, that's okay.
2 years ago, my dad committed suicide. And after that, I got on heroin. I got on heroin buying it in this town that I've lived in for 23 years. At any given time, I can walk up and down the street and I can buy it if you know the right people. People who live here, people who are influential people in this town. That is who I was buying heroin from. On any given day, between $100 to $300 worth of heroin, I was doing a day. And I mean, I don't care about the marijuana. I don't care. You know, that's, in a lot of ways, that's what Yellow Springs is known for. It does not bother me. But I cannot count how many friends I have lost because of this drug, how much I have personally lost, how much my mom has lost due to it. And you guys have got to do something, anything. And to think that the task force is not needed here, you guys are dead wrong. Dead wrong. Every time I try to get sober, Thursday, I walked down the street and caps of heroin were pushed in my hand, trying to get me to relapse so they could get that $300 a day again. And it's every single day. And I struggle with it, and I struggle with it, and I actually took the heroin. I was pretty proud of myself, took it up to the police department and dropped it off. But I can't tell you tomorrow I'd do the same thing. And I can tell you a lot of my friends probably couldn't do the same thing. And I also, you know, Brittany Butler, I've known almost my whole entire life. And granted, she OD'd in Dayton. That don't mean she didn't get it here. I can almost guarantee you she got it here. Mikey Edwards, I've known my whole entire life. And his life had to be saved a few months ago. It's bought here. At any given time, to think that it's not needed here, the task force is not needed here. I understand you guys may not agree with their, some of the things that they do. I understand the money factor, but when I got my drug test results back and the lab called to see which morgue I was in because the fentanyl levels in my system were so high they thought I was dead, you can't tell me it's not needed here at all. You know, and I know you guys aren't seeing that side of things, you know, but I know Judy's seen my son cry over this. You know, my children suffer because of, you know, what I became after that, and I regret it every day and I can't take it back. But if I can stand up here and hopefully save one more person from going through what I went through and my family went through, and you guys have the perfect opportunity to try and help. Absolutely. It is bad here. It is extremely bad. And I guess if you're not around it, you don't know how bad it is. But I could walk out this door and have it within 5 minutes and not have to walk a block. So, I mean, please think about that. So,
Thank you. Thanks, Jessica. Anything, are you going to follow up on that? Does anybody have anything, because this can fit into our next discussion, does anybody have anything that isn't at all about the task force or?
Right, so this is a time for things that are not on our agenda, so anything that has,
because
not the task force or Glen Helen annexation.
Because then we'll just move into those, into that task force discussion if there isn't anything else. Okay. So thank you so much for your comments, Jasmine. We're moving into a discussion about the task force. This will, I don't even know how many we've had. The last one was really dominated by, you know, by discussion of national issues of the war on drugs, you know, more how it's impacting the country as opposed to what Jasmine was just talking about and what's happening in Yellow Springs. And I feel that for myself, I said at that meeting that I felt like I needed more information. For myself, I still feel like the picture's not coming together for me as far as how this is really hitting us locally. And when I hear comments like that, when I read the letter from Kirsten Skaggs that was in the packet, other people that I know that I've talked to, there really are legitimate concerns about what's happening in Yellow Springs. And so I would like to move the discussion to that, to hearing from Chief. Chief had some material in the packet. Also, I noticed that Dr. Halley came in. I actually asked Dr. Halley to come to the meeting tonight. I spoke with him on Friday. He really wanted to have an opportunity to talk about drug treatment in Greene County, feeling that what he was able to talk about at the last meeting was pretty inadequate. So I did invite him here. Council, I don't know, as far as decision making, as far as where we want this discussion to go tonight, I guess I'll turn to you and ask for your thoughts.
Well, my thoughts are the same as yours, Karen, that we wanted to get specific as to the effects here in Yellow Springs. And the young lady spoke about her experience, and I looked at the view here in Yellow Springs. And I have a grandson that just graduated and went off to college. He could tell me every place in town where you could get marijuana or some other drugs that he wanted. I had to threaten him to keep him out of the land because he told me some of the activities that go on in the land. So, you know, I understand the national issues and what folks are doing nationally and here in our surrounding area. One of the reasons why we established the young people of color was to bring kids of color together and have them express their feelings about what goes on here in Yellow Springs and so forth. The event that we're having Thursday with the chief, where we're bringing all of the youth together to be able to ask questions and hear questions and answer it. From the chief. What really concerns me, and on both the surrounding areas and nationally, is the number of black youth, black young men that are dying from the hands of other black young men. And what I don't see is rallies around Black Lives Matter when we are losing a generation, another generation of black youth, not by police, not by car accidents, but by the hands of each other that want to control the drug market. So, you know, let's talk about Yellow Springs. And let's have a discussion on what type of signal or example we want to send to the rest of the country on drugs in general, and also how we can help save some of the lives of our black young men. So.
Any other comments at this point?
Yeah. I suspect we're not going to come to an agreement about whether or not to be in the drug task force. I mean, we'll vote on it, but I think people who think we should get out are not going to be convinced, probably, and vice versa. But what I do think that we can talk about and should talk about is what we want to do as a community about drug abuse, drug addiction, criminal activity about that. And from my point of view, and I've already stated that I think that we should get out of the task force, one thing is, I mean, clearly the task force is not being, maybe it's maintaining at a certain level drugs coming in, but clearly it is not being effective for people like yourself. And as long as we think that the drug leave it to the drug task force, well, it'll be like it is. So if we're really concerned about this as a problem, then I think it takes a lot more, whether or not we're in the drug task force, it takes a lot more of the community coming together and the different groups in the community coming together and educating ourselves and finding out where this is happening, where heroin is being bought and sold, and doing something about it. I mean, clearly it's not easy, but as long as we just sort of say, well, I mean, the drug task force can handle it as well. It doesn't look like it is handling it for better or
I want to hear what citizens have to say. I don't want us to be pressured into making a decision at this meeting if we have not heard everything we need to hear, but I'm still committed to making that decision before the end of the year. So.
Did you want to say something? Or?
No, I think I'll wait and hear from citizens because there's a lot of people here who want to speak.
I'd like to start with Dr. Howland. That's to talk about treatment.
Are you
prepared?
Sure.
Could you
grab the podium? Franklin Halley, I'm a psychiatrist, physician, and a medical director at TCN Vehicle Services. And I know that I need to repeat everything I said at the last meeting. Other than to summarize, we're a very large organization. We serve adults and youth both for mental health and chemical dependency treatment. We have pretty robust treatment programs that are accessible. That's one of the things we really work on, is that anybody can come in any given week and initiate services. Specific to chemical dependency services, we do have just constant large numbers of people coming in every week from all over Greene County. It's very clear to us and to me that there's all the issues going on with heroin and other opiates here there's nothing unique about Yellow Springs. We like to believe that we're different than everywhere else, we are in certain ways perhaps, but in the basic ways, we're not. We serve people from all over Greene County, including Yellow Springs. And there's a lot of heroin in this part of the country, in Greene County, everywhere, and in Yellow Springs. That's very, very clear. Opiate treatment is very, very difficult. Once people are addicted, it's very hard to have successful treatment. It's not impossible. We do help many people. I sometimes feel badly that we don't help every single person that comes through the doors. There's a lot of people that just don't make it through treatment, at least the first time, maybe not the second or third or fourth time. And we do everything that we can we don't kick people out of the program when they relapse. We do everything we can to keep them in treatment because we know that's how we're going to hopefully save their life. This is one of the most highest morbidity, illness, and mortality death of any illness and condition in all medical care. People, if you're an opiate addict, addicted for 10, 20, 25 years, your chances of dying are really, really high at a very young age. about it every day in the paper. So how to prevent it is to not get started on opiates, obviously. And that probably has to start with a lot of education at all levels in the community. And that probably might be an initiative. I was thinking about this as I came over and listening to y'all talk. That might be an area that we really could upgrade, at least in our little town, and everywhere. So we're involved in the jail, law enforcement, with the legal judicial system. We have 3 full-time staff in the jail alone. So it's really a lot of issues. So maybe I should just take some questions.
Could you elaborate on the situation, on your interaction with the criminal justice system in Greene County and how that works and how many people you're able to help and, you know, where you see the problems being of?
Well, the three full-time staff we have in the jail are seeing people with mental health, and more so, they're seeing people with alcohol and drug-related issues, and they're in jail because of crimes related to alcohol and drug use and all the things that go with that. We regularly work with probation officers in the courts who are mandating people come to get services, and there's no really problem for people being forced to come to services. I mean, how many people are really like, yeah, I love being an addict? There's not too many of those around there. So they have a hard time getting into services, and so the legal judicial system, that leverage, sometimes helps them stay in treatment where they otherwise might drop out a little bit easier. So we feel like we have a really strong relationship with all the law enforcement agencies and the judicial system in Greene County. Judge Root, who's starting a Vivitrol court for medication-assisted treatment with Vivitrol, which is a blocking agent for opiates. We're the treatment provider for that program. We also use Suboxone, which is an opiate replacement therapy, similar to methadone, which we don't give methadone. But there's no one treatment that's highly successful. So everything you can do to keep people in treatment or to give them incentive to stay in treatment, they have a better chance to help them make it in the end, save their life, is what we hope. So.
Is there a greater investment that the county could be making in treatment? I know that one of the concerns that has been brought forward is that the county is investing in, they're not adding 120 beds, they're basically opening 120 beds that exist in the jail. They're funding operations of those 120 beds. They exist, they have been out of operation since 2009, I believe, and they're gonna, in 2016, they're gonna start. I mean, is that something you see as necessary? Is that something you see as potentially helpful as a place for addicts to have an opportunity to go through some drug treatment if they're
in jail? Well, we have our staff, the jail has the Greenleaf program where they use either one of the pods or a partial pod, I'm not exactly sure. We have a large number of people getting a behavioral treatment program for addictions already. If we need to put more staff in there, we will put more staff in there to help with that. Treatment is always, from the treatment side of things, treatment is effective compared to incarceration for helping people stop, okay, and cutting down societal costs. We have good resources for treatment on the mental health and chemical dependency side in Greene County for 2 reasons. One, the state Medicaid expansion allows most people who need treatment to get Medicaid, not all of them, which pays for services. And also the Greene County Mental Health Levy, which pays for people that don't have resources. So Greene County is particularly well positioned to meet the needs as best we can of people with these conditions. You know, some of the surrounding counties that don't have a levy, don't have a strong mental health agency, just by living on one side of the county line or the other, it's like night and day as to what's available to you. So I think there is an under awareness of what we do have available here. Our agency has expanded almost 50% in the last seven, eight years. Actually, almost 100% in our size. So we've grown tremendously because of the need and the ability to have payer sources that will pay for treatment so that people can come through the doors and initiate care.
So for Yellow Springers who are struggling with addiction, where would they go, or what do they do if they want to try to get services from your agent?
We have multiple walk-in clinics every week at Xenia and Fairborn offices, 6 days of Monday through Thursday and on Saturday now. And all they have to do is show up at one of those walk-in clinics. They can call ahead of time, or they can just come without calling.
How do they find out where they are?
They would call our number, TCM Behavioral Health Services, which is in the newspaper every week. We have an ad every week in there. Or they can look us up online or
phone. Do you have flyers?
You know what? I was like, why didn't I bring stuff? Yeah, we have lots of flyers. And I can bring some down here for.
But I mean, that's something that could be put around town and the schools and the churches at this place, everywhere.
Yeah, it would be good to have flyers.
Has there ever been a consideration given to maybe having a what would have to be done to have, say, a one day a week kind of walk in situation in Yellow Springs? I mean, is that even possible to have kind of a remote clinic on an occasional basis, or remote?
Yes, it would be possible, and it would just, I mean, it's all possible. We aren't required to have our services just in our buildings. We have them in our buildings, we have them in the jail system, we can have them anywhere that our staff would go. So that's definitely something that could be explored.
Well, I have a question, and it's probably, I don't know that it's something you can answer, but what I understood you to say is that once someone's been addicted on opiates, it's a real struggle to get off. So it's easier to not get addicted. What are the what are there particular set of factors that are going to be leading someone toward getting addicted, and are there particular things that you could see, for example, our community doing to help people who might be, you know, leaning that way to get something else?
Well, that gets into a pretty broad area.
Yes, I understand.
You know, we talk about the patterns in our medical practice in the United States, dental practices, patterns of people looking for a pill to take care of everything. We have all the Vicodin in the world, 99% of it is consumed in the United States. So we have a culture where people take pills. And if you get started on an opiate, in any situation, even if it's for a good situation, like maybe acute surgical where you're cut open and you need it, you're at risk for becoming addicted. And I think there's been an under-awareness until just recently of how high that risk is. And so the number one thing is just don't use the opiates, because once you use them, it doesn't have anything to do with being a good person, a bad person, a smart person, an uneducated person, whatever race you are, whatever age you are. Just simply a matter of if you use opiates, you have a very high chance of becoming addicted to them. And it's much higher than I think in the medical profession has ever been appreciated until just recently it's starting to change. There's still a long ways to go.
And I think right now it's much easier and less expensive to get heroin than it is to get prescription.
Yeah, that's exactly what happens. You can buy all the pain pills on the street rather than a few blocks of here. But as you use them longer and longer, the price is just so high that it's much easier to go to heroin, because you can get it, just get more bang for your buck, I guess. It's cheaper, and it's everywhere. So
the closest one is probably the place at 600 East Dayton, Yellow Springs Road?
Yeah, we're about equal from Yellow Springs and Fairborn office and the Xenia office. It's maybe a mile or two longer from Xenia.
Right, and that number is 937-879-3400. So if people want to put that into their phones, either for yourself or someone you care about, it's good to know.
And I'm guessing both of those are on the yellow route to the Green Cats.
And Green Cats will come. We also have a specific contract that anyone who wants with Green Cats, just from our agency, that anybody who wants to come to an appointment can come for free on Green Cats, on a special ride that they can arrange through us. So we've done everything we can to help get people accessible and get people to be able to come there.
Okay. I see, I saw Judith with her hand raised.
Yeah. Given that many people have chronic severe pain, and you're saying that this don't go to the opiates, so what is the alternative for people with chronic severe pain?
Well, I'm not an expert on chronic pain management, but I've seen a lot. Even just simply Motrin and acetaminophen, things like that, turned out to be some of the stuff I've read recently as effective as people on long-term opiates. What happens, we appreciate now, people on opiates, you become hypersensitive to pain, so you feel like your pain's worse, but really it's the opiate changing the physiology in your brain and body so that you're more sensitive to pain. And so the doctors, you go to your doctor, your healthcare provider, and you're hurting more, and so they increase the dose, which is a really vicious cycle. And the death and destruction from being on the opiates long term is so high that that alone just becomes a major factor of why people shouldn't be on it for long-term chronic pain. So, and I've had the experience of having a sore back and going to a doctor, which I won't name, and on the way out the door, well, you sure you don't want a few Percocets or Vicodins just in case it's bad? And it was just in the last year. And I'm just like, I was shocked. And that's really normal medical practice still, even with the heightened awareness, it still hasn't kicked in, which is why the state is regulating opiate practices a lot more, opiate prescription, because the medical profession hasn't been great at managing it.
So, well, I think it did start out, as Judith asked, that patients were feeling pain. And I think that there was this feeling maybe 10 years ago or so, that we really should be treating, doctors should be treating pain instead of ignoring it, and it just kind of started a cycle.
That's exactly right. There's been huge push in the medical professions, healthcare professions, to increase treatment of pain and to be sensitive to that. And in the area just of the opiate modality, it's sort of gotten pretty much out of control. So there's huge societal issues and healthcare issues, and there's our little issues which get caught up. I mean, our smaller issues, Yale Springs, which are the same issues in a lot of ways. Very complex.
Carol, did you have a question?
I was hoping we would get to the topic.
Yeah. Okay, just I have a couple questions, if you don't mind. You talked about mandating, a lot of people that are busted for crime, trying to get drugs or whatever. Is it true that, does it tend to be true that people who go involuntarily for help do better than those that have been mandated by the police?
That seems like a logical thing, but it's not necessarily true at all. If you get people in treatment and they stay in treatment, as I said, I mean, who really wants to live with an addiction? Mm-hmm. I mean, it's just people really don't want to. So if you can keep them in long enough, it really works either way. Either they're voluntarily or they're there with extra leverage because of the judicial system or whatever.
Because I had read somewhere where it said that they tend to just get up and leave and don't follow the program, plus it takes about 7 months.
Well, it happens more times than we would wish, but also that's for people that voluntarily come in.
Okay. Now, can people in Green County go to other communities? Because there are, surprisingly, a lot of places out there in Dayton, Springfield, that have, like TCN, that people can go to also. Do we advertise that? Do we want to? Should we, or should we stay within the county?
A lot of chemical dependency treatment involves a lot of intensive groups and programs, and if you go too far, the logistics of getting back and forth, we find it really difficult. We get lots of requests from people outside of Green County, and we serve people outside of Green County to come to us, but we limit it. Our chemical dependency program, it just doesn't work. They come from Springfield or Dayton, there's just too much traveling back and forth and they just can't make the appointments. So I think there's a lot of advantages for doing it close. Plus, I will say we have a very strong program and we're recognized regionally as having a very strong program. I mean, we're not perfect, no place is perfect. So we have a pretty high level set of resources here. But yes, people can go anywhere, Medicaid, you can go to a lot of different clinics, private insurance, you can go to some clinics. TCM can take all payer sources, which is highly unusual.
Okay, and maybe this question will be for a little later, maybe for the chief. Thank you, so I appreciate it. Because I was just curious, I guess I still don't understand what the drug task will accomplish with our people here in Yellow Springs particularly.
Yeah, that's probably a little bit of a wait for that.
Jasmine, I saw you have your hand up. Do you have a question? I think Allison does too.
Yeah, it's actually for you. Weeks after weeks, I showed up at TCN to try and get help. I was actually there at 7 o'clock in the morning while I was supposed to be there at 7:30. There was over 20 people in line in front of me, and I was told you guys take the first six. So, I mean, you guys have a real bit, I know you guys have your hands full, but when you have people there showing up to get help and you say, well, we're only taking the first six, so the other 30, come back next week and let's hope you survive. That makes no sense.
Yeah, it's definitely not a good situation in our walk-in clinics. We can handle a certain number of people, and sometimes we do turn people away. The way it's supposed to happen is people are then arranged with an appointment and come back as a priority at one of the next clinics, and maybe that doesn't always happen perfectly. But it's pretty astounding the number of people that come in for services. But we want to do everything we can to get them in and get started. As I said, we're not 100% perfect.
No. But putting one in the
springs,
as you said, because the need is severe here. Even if it was just one day a week, because, I mean, just me alone, I'm not driving right now. So, I mean, I know there's the Green Cats, but making it more accessible to the people here, maybe it wouldn't be such an issue. Or maybe they wouldn't end up in the situation I was in where, you know, I was 10th in line and you're only taking the first six, so I guess I can come back next week and let's hope you make it. And that's what it is every single day. Let's hope you make it for the next day.
Talis, did you have a comment or question from Dr. Howard?
I had a question. I want to know if you were going to add some
sort of. I have not been an addict.
So for someone that's not an addict, how can you help in that? See, my thing is I think only people that have been addicted to something and got off of it could be the only person to help somebody that's addicted to something. You could go to school and get all this education on something as much as you want and sound good, you know, and be real educated about it. But if you haven't went through it and have no experiences to relate to that person that's going through that struggle, then you're going to fall short every time. That's why Alcohol Anonymous is so good. I like that organization or that phone or that group because, I mean, they need each other. Like, the people that survive still need those people, and those people need them also. Like, I can do it. I'm showing you can do it, and you can do it also. Like, it's a thing where they have the knowledge and the experience, and it goes back and forth. And another thing I want to say is, you know, somebody's in jail for like 3 months, 6 months, and they get out. And part of their deal when they get out is that they have to go through TCN. It's such that you make them pay when they get out for TCN. That's something that he didn't mention, is that they have to pay to get out of TCN after they're in for 6 or 8 months or whatever it is. And a lot of people take that Green League program just so they can get out of jail quicker, just to get back to that hit or that blast or whatever you want to call it, or that drug. You know, a lot of people, I've seen it. You know, that Green League program is like a snitch program. I mean, I've seen people go in from being on the Green League side back into the regular pile with all the regular folks that's in there. And it really don't help nobody inside. You know, a lot of people was going to TCN in there because the lady that ran the one in Green County as any was a female. We looked at men all day. So shoot, I signed up for it, you know? But I didn't need it, you know? So I mean, it's not gonna really help nobody in there because they can't get out to get to that drug. They just can't get to it, you know? And then when they get out, it's up to them if they gonna stay with it or not.
Well, I would just say that, I'm not gonna say that I as a human being can fully understand any of it. But I have the skills and training and knowledge base to do everything I can to help them with the resources that I have available to me, whether I'm an addict or not. And I'm going to go back for people to do what I can.
Appreciate that.
And
that's tough, man.
if people don't have money, we do have reduced fees. Yes, we do charge people. We do reduce fees, and we're willing to work it out as best we can.
And it's another thing, so it's not also for people that just go in because they're on some kind of drug, you know. They put me in there for anger management, you know. It wasn't drug related, and I was in SOP too. They had SOP 1 and all these other different.
Yeah, I'm still trying to understand about the connection between opiates and addiction. The example that was given to me is people who are victims of physical trauma, like tomorrow I'm crossing the street, I get hit by a car, a fraction, several bones broken. In the hospital, I would be given morphine, which is an opiate. Is that right?
That could be, yes.
Okay, so, and for however many weeks it takes me or, you know, anybody to recover, I'm on that. And then, so when I come out, I am automatically at a greater risk of becoming addicted to an opiate.
Probably would be in that situation, yes, just by the fact that you've been on opiates. And the longer you're on them, more chance of an addiction. Is it 100%? No. Mm-hmm. So,
quite a lot of people, I imagine.
It's a lot of people.
That's a lot of people.
Okay. The one thing I think is, do you do educational programs? Do you, or does TCN go into the schools to do any educational programs?
Yeah, we have a whole youth division. We have prevention groups that are youth prevention therapists. You can always do more prevention, more education. I mean, there's.
And I assume you're on our schools.
I think we are back in Yellow Springs schools.
Okay.
Now.
Thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you.
Oh, good.
I did have a question. If we know that opiate addiction often comes through like drugs administered by doctors in hospitals, wouldn't it make more sense to do preventative care as people are being weaned off opiates rather than trying to use the drug task force to prevent this addiction?
And your name, please?
Jessica Thomas.
Yeah, well, it gets into a lot of crossover and maybe some different issues. But yes, there's, I think, a lack of awareness, and there has been a lack of awareness in the medical profession for sure about the ramifications of all this. That's why there's been new laws in the state about restricting the amount of opiates that doctors can prescribe and doing different things. It's much harder as a physician to prescribe opiates than it ever was. And because there's more knowledge now of what can happen.
So, I would like to hear from Chief. Do you want to take some time to review your comments that you provided in the packet? Do you have anything additional to say?
I'll have to go faster, I guess. I know one of the questions is what is the difference between what does the task force do? What Dr. Halley is talking about is addiction. The task force does not go after addicts. They go after traffickers. They go after people who are selling serious weight, major weight as it's been referred to. They also go after doctors. Anytime where you see where a doctor has been charged with overprescribing, chances are that is a task force that has done that. The design of the task force is organized crime. Organized crime is not the addict. That is not their focus. They are going after the people who are selling large quantities. These people are often armed. They are serious money, and there is violence that comes with those individuals. Are we going to stop it? No, sure not. You have amps in your home. Are you going to do something about them? Yeah. Are they going to come back? Yes. But you still do something about them. I feel like my role here is if we had an intersection in the middle of town, and this intersection had crashes more than other intersections, you would be looking to me going, let's do something about this to reduce the risk of someone being hurt or killed. When I look at drugs, that's what I think I should do. Do something the best of our ability to keep people from being hurt or killed. And I believe if we look back at what John Grody said, After the Timothy Lopez murder, his eyes were open. I can read the quotes too if you want to hear them. But he woke up and saw that's what will happen. I can't guarantee you that we're going to stop it. Evidence shows that's not the case. Police officers are not opposed to getting these individuals in treatment. Anyone who runs a jail will tell you it is a much, much better way. Cost-wise, cost-effective-wise, they don't need to be in jail. They need treatment. So, you know, there are two different issues here, the addict and the traffickers. And the design of the task force is the large individuals, the violence associated with them.
Are traffickers addicts?
Most traffickers are not addicts. If you're a heroin addict, you probably are not using heroin. You may be smoking a little weed or other things or party dough, but you're usually not an addict. If you're an addict, you're going to use what you've got.
So my understanding is the task force goes on. Our question is not whether the task force should exist. Our question is whether Yellow Springs should have a direct officer kind of assigned to the task force. And so I asked you last week, the question that I was trying to sort out is, having an officer on the task force, what's, because many villages are sized, Jamestown, Cedarville, the only towns that contribute, there's what, six officers in Green County?
So there's six departments that contribute, they have actually 10 detectives right now.
All right, okay, so many smaller communities do not contribute, but I've read about people in those communities getting arrested by the task force. So the task force still operates in communities, regardless of whether they are actively sending an officer into the task force.
The task force has that ability. As I said in my written response, you know, if it was a matter of funding, if it's a matter of taxes, if this is done as a reduction of the police department, I think the ACE task force would be sympathetic. If we pull out because we're morally opposed to the large message it's sending and the bias that is in the system, because there is bias in the system, I would be very, very hesitant if I was running that task force or if I was a board member to let my guys go back on my dime and my overtime to work something in Yellow Springs. Now, would they, if they had a big case and a portion of it came to Yellow Springs, they'd work that case to the fullest. But if it was something exclusive to Yellow Springs, my guess is they would turn it down. And I think the other thing you've got to remember is there's not just people in Yellow Springs selling heroin. There's people from Dayton and Springfield and surrounding areas come here. And anyone in the dope game will tell you that these guys that are delivering heroin almost always are armed. Am I correct?
Yep.
There, if I lived in Xenia and I said, hey, I got some money, bring me 10 caps of heroin, do you think that guy's going to drive to Xenia where there's undercover officers, or is he going to tell the buyer, dude, I'll meet you in Yellow Springs? So by pulling out, we're going to be the soft target. And again, financially, if that's where we have to go, that is your decision, clearly within your discretion. If we pull out mainly because of moral opposition to it, I don't look for the task force to be very sympathetic to us.
Can you tell me what the officer gets in terms of, or what we get from having an officer on the task force? Does that make sense? Like,
well, I mean, there's an experience level, there's certain training, clearly. You have a responsiveness. We not only do you have an officer on the task force, you have a chief of police on the board of directors. So if we have a problem, I have influence on what they do and what they don't do. You know, we specifically had an instance back in, I can't remember, early this year, an individual was speeding, was doing 60 miles an hour through the Platte. We're able to get that individual. We find a couple caps of heroin on him. Because of the heroin, our detective came in with his experience and interviewed the guy. We ended up getting confession, not only for the heroin, not only for a burglary down the street that he did and recovered property from the neighbor down the street from where he lived, but we also got a confession for the individual that was passing counterfeit bills in our stores. I mean, it is that kind of experience, training. Anytime there's a violent crime, if it's in a home, there's going to be a search warrant written, almost always. I don't have an officer in the department that I know of outside the ones who've been on task force who have written a search warrant. If that search warrant gets thrown out of court, all the evidence gets thrown out of court. They're crucial. That sort of that is the kind of training and experience we get.
So does that officer, how much time does that officer spend in Yellow Springs doing things like you were just describing?
As much as we need them. You know, it could be that they're running a big case that has very little to do with Yellow Springs. It happens, maybe for a month or two. But if we have a problem in Yellow Springs, I don't have one officer doing it. I now have 10. I have the equipment, the expertise, the unmarked vehicles. I mean, all those resources are not at my disposal, because what they do is I kick that case to the commander and they run the case.
Well, okay, given the example you gave of the person you caught that had the heroin and had been passing counterfeit, if we wouldn't have had that officer, if you wouldn't have been able to call our officer from the task force, would you have called another officer from the task force? Would they have supplied somebody else to come here? Would you have taken them to Xenia? I mean, what would have happened in that scenario?
Our patrol officer interviewed him and pretty much got nowhere. Again, if I pulled my guy out of the task force and I said, hey, Bruce, would you do me a favor and send a Xenia detective here to interview this guy? I don't think that would happen. Unless, of course, maybe he fits into a bigger picture that I'm not seeing. I guess that could happen, because they run cases and I don't know all their cases.
Do you have these skills?
I'd like to think so. I mean, you know, clearly, although they're rusty because I've been an administrator for quite a few years, what helps, again, though, is knowing the players, knowing the names. If somebody drops a name out of Xenia, I have no idea who that individual is. If it's someone that's around Dayton 15 years ago, I probably know.
I have another question. I find the structure of the task force odd. I mean, if it's concerned about Greene County, and I understand it goes outside of Greene County, I don't understand why it's not like countywide and is concerned about Yellow Springs or Cedarville or any place. I don't understand why a community, and especially like Yellow Springs has, well, I think 2% of the population in Greene County, that by providing an officer, we're providing 1/10 of the staff, which is, well, we don't have that much.
It's not even close.
Can you explain a little bit about the structure? Why is it set up so that it's not really, if it's going to work in the county, why doesn't it work equally in the county rather than only in?
Well, I think when it was initiated, this conjecture on my part, that the agencies who wanted to be involved became involved. After the Timothy Lopez murder, Chief Grody came to council. Council approved for us joining. That's how we got in. You know, that's how the structure came to what it is. Prior to that, clearly there's, things going on throughout the county. I'm not saying they would not come out here if we asked. Not saying that. I'm saying if I was on that board of directors, I would weigh a lot of factors before I sent them back. If we pull out, again, not because of the financial situation, but because of our moral decision, which is, again, the village's to make. I'm not saying it isn't. And if money is the issue, I think they'd be far more sympathetic to us. But if we pull out and don't reduce staff, and you were sitting on that board?
Well, I guess if it exists in order to diminish drug trade and criminal activity in the county, then the board would be concerned about wherever it's happening.
Well,
I've got a question. I am guessing that is the task force funded by Greene County, or is it funded by a grant? If it's funded by a grant, it's almost like the task force has a board that is the operating board. So it isn't, I mean, tell me if I'm correct, that it isn't really a Greene County operation. It is a board that's been set up, a structure that's been set up by the people that are members. So it's not Greene County Sheriff's Office.
Right, it's not
Greene County.
It is ran by a board of directors. And part of your answer is, and you heard it, there's more drug dealers out there than there are detectives. The question isn't, again, would they come here? The question is, they would prioritize things. And, you know, we pull out, would I think they would prioritize something that was exclusive to Yellow Springs very high? I don't. I mean, if they had it.
I mean, you got to admit, though, that does sound kind of like blackmail. Like, if we had never been in, then they might treat us fine. But because we got in and we might pull out, then they're going to punish us. That just seems so, that logic is troubling to me. And then the other thing that I worry about is we did have an officer who used the training provided by ACE Task Force as the reason for a couple of incidents in town that involved, you know, well, the big one was taking the camera from the person, saying, I can't do this because I'm being undercover. So I get very concerned if good community policing is interfered with because of the kind of training they're getting on ACE Task Force. If it's turning us into the danger and we're being treated all as dangerous people because of undercover training, that's very concerning to me.
Mm-hmm. When people make mistakes, they use a lot of excuses. From point one, I told the village that's an excuse and it did not hold water for me. I worked undercover for 5 years in Montgomery County. I went to court 3 and 4 times a week. I testified against people. I walked into the county jail. If I'm worried about somebody taking my picture when I'm not even in an active, true undercover role, and I'm in a surveillance car over here, to me that's BS. I thought it was BS then, I think it's BS now. As far as them not being responsive to Yellow Springs, again, I'm not saying they won't, but they also have to be responsive to their taxpayers, because the taxpayers of Fairborn and Beaver Creek and the Sheriff's Office, which we are a portion of, albeit a small portion of, Fairborn, Beaver Creek, Xenia, they're responsive to their people. So the question for that chief becomes is, you're in Yellow Springs and they pulled out of the task force and you're spending our tax dollars to go over there. They would be questioned just like you. It may be unfair, and again, you make the decision you need to make. That's your decision. I've never doubted that.
Okay. And I just circled on, I mean, I hate to say it, but on the memorandum of understanding, the purpose of the ACE task force is to investigate crime throughout Greene County.
But I think that Chief's point was that, and correct me if I'm wrong, that with limited men and limited resources, they will go where their resources allow them to make.
When you have multiple cases, you prioritize those cases and you look at the potentials, what level, how long this is going to take. And the bottom line is, if I said, hey, I got a guy and he's selling ounces of heroin tomorrow, and when I expect them to jump and go, yep, we'll take care of it, we'll spend all these hours and do that, when it affects only Yellow Springs, no. If their caseload is heavy, I do not expect them to do that. That's my opinion. I could be wrong. I'd like to think they would do better, but you're asking me my opinion. I think they'll be much more conservative with that.
Well, I do agree with Mary Ann that we provide 1/8 of the task force and we're a tiny percent of this. I mean, Beaver Creek is 100,000 people, right?
No,
I think 40, the county's
40.
Oh,
the county's only like 100,000 people.
No, 160.
County's 160 and we're 3,000 and we're providing 10% of the manpower. That just feels like an inequity, especially
when it is supposed to serve the whole of Greene County. I don't like the sort of private structure.
And it is interesting. It is an interesting private structure, I think. You know, it really does when you've got, it is supposed to be a, as I just read, to protect all of Greene County, but there is, you know, a structure that makes it somewhat exclusive to those participants. That's why I thought, actually, it wouldn't say that. You know, I really thought it was a board organization that pretty much served the communities that, prioritized the communities that were members.
And as you said, they do cases in Germantown or Jamestown, other places. I'm not saying they would never come back. That was not my point.
We know what you're saying.
And
I get it.
The entry and exit, the ease of entry and exit to the task force. You know, I mean, we could say tonight that we want to leave the task force, and I don't know when it would be effective. I don't know if we could say, you know, pending clearing cases.
It's,
you know,
yeah,
I would say that we would have to make that, you know, very, you know, language that made sense. Let's say something happened in next year and we decided this isn't a good idea, that maybe we should go back in. I assume that it's something that we can get back into if we...
Yes, I would assume so, yes.
I'm personally not, my decision is not going to be one of repudiating the task force and the task force tactics. It will be more of a financial and decision on equity for having a community the size of Yellow Springs funding such a large amount. Council, any other comments, questions to Chief? Do we want to hear from citizens?
Yeah. If I may have 30 seconds.
Sure.
Just during the interview, original interview, I said at the very beginning, we need to pull out the task force because of financial reasons. That makes perfect sense to me. I apologize if I came across like a threat. That was not what I was trying to do. You asked staff for opinions. I am telling you what sitting on, when I ran a task force, been on boards of directors for that, I gave you my opinion. I did not mean it to be threatening in any way.
Yeah, I didn't take it as you threatened.
Okay.
It's the structure that's concerning me. Nothing that you personally said.
Understood. Thank you.
Thanks, Chief. Kate?
And if you have questions for Chief, what we can do, what we usually do is sort of collect questions and then kind of answer them so that we can get as many voices heard as possible. So if you have a question that's directed to Chief, we'll write it down and we'll make sure he answers them.
Okay. This is sort of, I'm sorry, Kate Hamilton. This is kind of along the lines of budget. Drugs are here, drugs are bad, I think we got that. Task force is not working, apparently, for us. You will be talking about annexing the Glen and having our police force cover a larger area than they have been. And I think that will increase the budget because I don't think that you can have two cops. I guess I'll discuss that later. I would suggest that if we get off task force, then you can have that extra officer. We won't have to increase the budget. It'll stay the way that it is. Or you consider getting a social worker. A lot of the stuff that the police do can be handled by a social worker. And that person can work with the people that are affected by the drugs and find the help that they need rather than jail them.
Thanks, Kate. Anyone else? Why am I going blank? I'm sorry. I'm going blank on your name. Pat.
Pat DeWeese. I just want to comment about our expectations of services for the task force. One of the members of the task force is the Greene County Sheriff's Office. Another is the Greene County Prosecuting Office. So I assume since we pay taxes that support those two offices that we would reasonably assume that they would respond to issues that we had here in our village. So I guess I just have that comment in terms of what would we lose. I mean, I hear the chief talking about certain things that we might lose, and I think he has a case, but I think we also, considering our size, that it would be reasonable, we would expect that if we really had a problem, that we could assume that at least the sheriff's office would respond to that.
Okay.
Thanks, Pat. Joan?
I think we can take it, it's us.
Yeah, because I'm not seeing it, yes.
Joan Chappelle, my concern is similar to Laurie's, that we may get less service from the task force if we pull out. And I'm wondering, before the task force, our officers seemed adequate to prevent crime and to address crime that was drug-related. So I don't know that these officers that we have now have no training in arresting drug trafficking. I think they do. And I hope that we do pull out of the task force and put some monies into, hopefully, into the schools and getting some of the heroin out of Yellow Springs, whether or not the task force comes into town. To me, it's a Green County task force, and their mission is Green County, so I don't understand why they would stop at the village line if they have a big case. Thank you.
Steve McQueen.
Steve.
And then Judith.
I saw it.
I thought I did too.
Oh, Elizabeth.
Hi, I'm Steve McQueen. I'm here as Secretary of HRC. And basically just want to say that at our last meeting, a citizen came to us asking if we would make a decision as to whether we would come to you guys and if we would back or not back the ACE Task Force and us continuing to stay on it. And unanimously, we all came into agreement on this letter. The Human Relations Commission has conducted several forums and surveys on policing issues within our village. The subject of our police department's involvement in the ACE Task Force has come up in the top tier of citizens' concerns at forums, on surveys, and at council meetings, as well as our meetings. The majority of these villagers stated that they want the Yellow Springs Police Department to end their membership on the ACE Task Force. Our commission is tasked with advising council of possible courses of action in regard to trending issues within the village. In regard to the task force issue and taking into account the due diligence that we have done as well as the feedback from the community, we are recommending to Village Council that the Yellow Springs Police Department be removed from the ACE Task Force.
Thank you, Steve. John, go ahead now, John.
Hello. So I guess just like wanting to reframe the debate slightly, I read the chief's letter, and it seems like the question was being posed between regulation and prohibition, except that obviously we don't have the powers here as a municipality to create a regulatory regime for drugs, so well the chief acknowledged that there might be reasonable reasons for establishing such a regulatory regime. We're not capable of doing it. But it seems to me that what we're really faced with is a question of whether we want the task force to be more productive by, you know, enabling it, giving it money, and giving it another officer, or less productive. And so the central question seems to be, well, how effective is drug enforcement at lowering drug use? And so it continues to be puzzling to me that it seems like I don't feel like the chief really responded to that, or that the council members have been asking questions in that direction. Certainly it seems like the public health research that's been done on the question has generally fallen to the direction that it basically has no effect on drug use at all. And so then you're just left with that basically productivity for the task force seems to just mean increased incarcerations, not decreased drug use. And I mean, it's not just me that thinks that that's the point of the drug war. Like, if you look at the U.S. Office of National Drug Policy, like, that is the point of the drug war, is to reduce drug use. If drug enforcement does not reduce drug use, it has no purpose. So that's really the central question here. And once again, there's been like lots and lots of studies on the question. You know, there's different levels of enforcement in different communities. Like, the information should be out there to sort of make that call as to whether or not drug enforcement is an effective policy for reducing drug use. Of course, treatment is more effective. I'd still be interested in looking at, you know, how effective it is, looking at the differences between, you know, people being compelled into treatment versus voluntary. But anyway, I guess I've gone on long enough. Thank you.
Thanks, Trey.
Thank you.
Elizabeth?
Good evening. This is my daughter over here.
Huh?
Oh, I'm sorry. My name is Elizabeth Stardancer. This is my daughter, Jasmine. I've been fighting for over a year with heroin. As most of you know, I own a shop downtown, right on the corner. I can see the whole entire town from my corner. I sit right at the corner window of my board. I have no customers, or if I'm not tattooing, I watch what's going on for entertainment. I see weekly drug deals. Weekly. I see them on the street. I see them passing their hands. I see them at the post office, sitting on the bench, passing the drugs, passing the money. And I want to run to somebody and say something, but am I going to get shot? Am I? If you do not allow the task force to help with this drug problem, I can tell you right now, and I'm going to blow your minds, you have a drug dealer in this room right now that is fighting against it, so you don't have so much help here. You have one in here. You do. Do you know that? You have a drug dealer in here. I know probably 10 of them in town.
She's not talking, let me straighten that out. She's not talking about pot or anything like that. She's talking about you
about
have
pot.
A heroin dealer standing in this room.
Fighting against you not having the task force. Fighting against not having help. I'm fighting my children's lives here. She has been getting help, but how could she get help and walk out of a room at your office, and then you walk down the street, hey Jazz, what's going on? Slip her a couple of tabs. And you're like, oh my God, I'm trying to get better. I'm trying to get my children back. But Joe Blow here is slipping me more drugs. Just giving them to her free, so you know you'll take that one. What are you gonna do when you take the one? You're going to take another one. I can't go to the art council concerts and bring my little 5-year-old and my 10-year-old because I sit in the seat and watch drugs being passed forward with the concerts. Do you know that? I watch it all the time. I don't go there no more because of it. I see so much drug activity in this town. It is mind-blowing. Mind-blowing. And I'm scared to say anything to anybody because I was going to buy a t-shirt and design it and put it in my windows. It says, shoot your local heroin dealer. Because I was connected to a company in Cincinnati or fighting what I'm fighting. And they said, if I put that t-shirt in the window, I'd probably be shot myself. I hate heroin. I hate drugs of any kind. I do not use drugs. I don't want my children or anybody in this town. Yes, it needs to be addressed from the small all the way up to the high school kids. It does need to be addressed better. It's rampant in there. There's heroin use in high schools. I hear from the street kids. They're in my shop all the time, they tell me.
I had 14-year-old daughter can tell you. She has, it's being passed around. And I mean, everybody wants to say the task force isn't doing anything. Well, nobody's helping them do anything.
If
you know your neighbor is selling heroin,
you
don't
know
how
to
if you take the task force away, you can take one crumb away from help. And we lose one more child in this town, one more child in this town that we lose of heroin because maybe they might have helped, then it's all on these people here. If my child dies or your neighbor child dies because you took it away, one child, can you look yourself in the mirror and say, oh dang, well maybe we could have had them here. Maybe they might have helped a little bit.
You have 3 minutes.
Thanks, Elizabeth. I have a question. So you see drug deals
all the time.
All the time.
All the time.
Are the people who are selling drugs, are they residents?
Yes.
So they're local people?
Yes.
You know who they are?
Yes.
Other people know who they are?
Yes.
But they're not being reported.
Do I want to be shot when I walk my 3-year-old down the sidewalk? I know half of the people in this town pack guns, the ones that are doing this. I'm scared to death. Just like I said, I'd like to hand that t-shirt, it had been a good novelty. She's your local heroin dealer. It's a jest, a joke, you know. In other words, I don't want to tolerate this here. But in the same mind, if I put that t-shirt in my window to sell it, I'm gonna be the one who's gonna be shot. I see drugs selling all the time on the streets, sitting in my little corner. All the time. It's really bad here. I can't express to anybody how bad it is here.
Thanks, Elizabeth. Carol? And then Al. I think Al had a second. And then Alice had a second.
Thank you. Carol Cobb, Scarborough Springs. First, I'd like to say to the young lady, I think you called her Jasmine, that took a lot of strength and bravery to do that. That is not easy, giving up that kind of information and to want help. So I appreciate that. On the other hand, I do think that if people are seeing some of the things that they talked about, anybody can pick up a phone and call it in or put an anonymous letter in the mail. And even if we had the task force, I'm not sure if they would solve this problem. I'm sorry, I wish they could, but I don't think they would. I think it would make a lot of things worse for our community. But I do think it depends upon us as a community, when we know these things, to report it. I also think, because she has knowledge of things, that maybe we need to ask more people here in the town, if anonymously they might want to report some things, or ask them what they feel they need. Now, that's what she's here for. I'm just not so clear on our needing it, but I can understand if she does. And then we maybe need to listen to her and a lot of others to see, are there ways we can do this to help people that have this problem, be it heroin or other kinds of drugs, by maybe not needing the task force. I think it's worth at least looking at and doing more questions and asking the people that are having problems. The best information is going to come from them. Like the one gentleman said, unless you've been involved in it, you may not know, have ideas about how to fix it. They should know, or at least they can listen to them. That's all.
Thanks, Carol. Excuse me, Carol. Al, you had a comment?
Yeah. I guess I'm really naive. I've lived in this town 45 years, and I've always felt safe. But I really appreciate the both of you having the courage to come and talk about this. So at least I'm aware. I leave my house and car have been unlocked 99.9% of the time. I guess I shouldn't say that with the TV camera on. I mean, but I really feel safe here, and I had no. I mean, I knew we had that problem in 2006, but this to me is the greatest evidence you could have that the task force is not working. I mean, goodness, if it's not able to do anything with people seeing all this stuff happening, it's clearly not working. Yellow Springs, to me, is a very creative place. I mean, we have our schools, we have the project-based learning, we want to have renewable energy, even though it costs a little more. We have community solutions working on new ways to solve things. I think we need to have people working with the chief, finding new ways. Maybe we could take this $80,000 we're spending and give half of it to Haley, Franklin, to get someone here in town to help people that are having these problems so that we can solve it. I mean, we need a creative solution. We don't need these old
things that are clearly not working, that are made, that are judged by how many people we put in jail rather than in helping the problems of people in our community. Let's look for some new creative ideas, not things that clearly don't work.
Thanks, Al. Alice?
First thing I wanted to say is you mentioned Sam's black on black crime and that it's not the police all the time. And no, it's not the police all the time. Yeah, it is black on black crime, but you gotta look at the situation they're in, you know, the conditions they're in. I don't know if you've been here your whole life, but you know, things happen in black communities that don't happen here. Some of it does, some of it doesn't. Another thing I also wanted to mention was, on record at our last meeting, you know, he called me a liar with a straight face on camera. That should say enough right there. I mean, I have nothing to lie about. I was open and told my case, you know, that I was a snitch, you know, for a short period of time. And I kind of went blank. It was a whole bunch of stuff I'm saying when I was sitting there and I'm up here. One thing I want to say is, yeah, I commend her and her mom for coming up here and saying that, but I believe the community can take care of the community. We don't need a task force, you know. I know somebody that can help her out and you out also. And then, I mean, it's that simple. If y'all know people that's doing it, tell me. I ain't afraid of guns. I grew up with them. Tell me.
What are you going to do, beat them up?
I'll deal with it, you know. I mean, the people can take care of each other. I mean, if we're working with them right now and they ain't solving nothing, then y'all still seeing it, man. And then if you ain't saying that, silence is violence. We talk about that all the time. If you ain't saying that, you're part of the problem also. You know, tell somebody that'll do something that ain't afraid, like me, and I'll deal with it, you know, however I have to. If I gotta put myself out there again, or if I gotta talk to somebody with a private letter or whatever the case may be, but we can take care of each other, you know. I think the people can take care of the people without having us have these people, you know, tapping people's phones and stalking folks like they did me 3 years ago when I first came in. You know, they watched me like, I mean, like y'all won't believe, and I wasn't born yesterday. I ain't stupid like that. Look at them, you know. So I just say, let the people take care of the people, and we'll be all right. Maybe we could just have another meeting like this with us that's sitting here that care about it, come up with something that we think can help people that have these situations. I mean, like I said, when I was sitting there before, only people that have been through what she's been through can help her. Like, I know, I mean, I learned a lot when I was in TCN. I did. But I wasn't ever hooked on that either. And if you haven't, it'd be hard for you to save somebody's life if you've never been hooked on it, because you don't know that feel, that hurts, that desire. And with me being somebody that was dealing it at one time, man, that stuff is strong. But that's all I gotta say. Just, you know.
Thanks, Thomas. Kelly?
Kelly? I'm sorry. I was trying to read lips and I'm really bad.
Can you hold up?
Yeah. Very short. Hi. So, yes, Kelly Gallagher. So, I just want to say, first of all, that there's been, it feels like, a lot of fear-mongering around drugs, especially by the police here, and I'm not here for fear-mongering, I'm not here for it, I'm tired of it. And I wish that Cheryl and Mumadi, who had spoken so eloquently at the last meeting, were given time to speak as long as, or you know, even just at all at this meeting, like the Yellow Springs police were given time to speak again. I want to say, I think it's inadequate and problematic to have us pull out of the task force only for budgetary reasons. I think we're all critically smart people, I would hope we're all critically minded people living in the 2015 in the world. And so we should understand the incredibly structurally racist and white supremacist war on drugs out of which such a task force even comes out of. And so we should pull out of the task force explicitly. We should have the courage to actually say, to bring up these issues and to not just to fall back on the budget, like that's the only reason. I think we need to talk about racism and white supremacy and policing, and it's incredibly problematic to not discuss that. I also think that that we should be providing treatment, and I think that instead of incarceration and increased policing, we should talk as a community about ways to provide adequate treatment for people experiencing addiction. I would be all for training in the Yellow Springs Police Department to create treatment centers for free to help people who are addicted. And if, you know, I'm just wondering how much our time is valued, because I feel like I was at this meeting last time, and 99% of people that stood up, all explicitly, except for one woman I remember, said we're against the task force. So I feel like my time, I feel like, I'm just wondering how much my time is valued as a community member when we all did this, and how is this still even a discussion that's happening? When 99% of the room said explicitly that they wanted Yellow Springs Police to pull out of the task force. So let's give money to treatment and not racist policing and incarceration. And also next week, for people interested, or this weekend, there's going to be some community actions around the death of Tamir Rice, whose anniversary is coming up next Monday. So let's get to the point where we can have conversations about decreasing policing and disarming the police, and move past this, which we've all explicitly said over and over and over and over again, that we want the Yellow Springs Police out of the task force.
Thank you. Judith?
Hello there. My name is Judith Hempoint. I just wanted to say read a little bit more from the Global Commission on Drug Policy, which is related to the United Nations, and which released a report in 2014 called Taking Control Pathways to Drug Policies That Work. And this commission the members of the commission include many, many former presidents of Latin American countries, of Colombia, Mexico, Brazil, Chile, as well as other major leaders of countries around the world, who were actually participating with the United States in the war on drugs in Latin America, and who came to the conclusion that it was very ineffective. And that's the reason that they formed this commission. There's going to be a big discussion at the United Nations in 2016. Yes, it's an international discussion, but we have things to learn from these kind of discussions, these large discussions that are looking at this world we live in, where there's a huge problem with drugs, and there's a huge problem with drug cartels. And in fact, this war on drugs, which has been going on for over 50 years, has been totally ineffective. It has, the war has been lost. And so it's not a contradiction to realize the great pain and horror of having a drug addiction and the difficulties that that brings for people, and to also say this policy does not work. I just wanted to read a little bit from it if I still have time. I also want to point out that other members are of this commission are George Shultz, the former Secretary of State of the United States, Paul Volcker, the former chairman of the U.S. Federal Reserve, Kofi Annan, the former Secretary General of the United Nations, the former UN High Commissioner for Human Rights. So these people are looking at this issue. The United Nations was involved initially in the war on drugs, and it is being viewed now by many international leaders who care about the problem of drug addiction deeply, see the terrible consequences, but also see the terrible consequences of this war. I'm just wanting to read a little bit out of this. The global drug prohibition, from this report, global drug prohibition has not only failed to achieve its original stated goals of creating a drug-free world, it has also generated alarming social and health problems itself. After more than a half a century of this punitive approach, there is now overwhelming evidence that it's not only failed to achieve its own objectives, it has also generated serious social and health problems. If governments are genuinely committed to safeguarding the safety, health, and human rights of their citizens, they must urgently adopt new approaches. Did you tell me my
time? Yes, the time, yeah.
Okay, I will stop there.
Thanks, Judith. The young lady here, and then we'll get the gentleman in the back, and then.
All right, my name is Lindsay Burke. It's my personal opinion that the moral reasons for exiting the task force should be more important than the financial reasons for them, but maybe that's why they're poor. Since we're talking a lot about the financial reasons, I'll touch on that briefly, and I think a lot of people have addressed the moral concerns, and I hope more people will bring those up. I wanted to address something that the chief said, and this is why it's specific, as Mr. Sims asked us to address. The chief said that the priority of the task force and the job of the task force is to go after high-level drug traffickers. And he said that if we pull out of the task force, that the task force would not come to Yellow Springs to address a Yellow Springs exclusive issue. And I want to know, what high-level drug trafficker is exclusive to Yellow Springs? And why wouldn't they be concerned about something that's happening here in Yellow Springs? Because a high-level drug trafficker doesn't have far to go to get to Beaver Creek, doesn't have far to go to get to Fairport, doesn't have far to go to get to Springfield. I just want to know where that disconnect happens and why we aren't thinking more logically about what's being said to us about the fear-mongering aspect. It's a threat, and it's not a very well-thought-out threat. I just think we should consider that.
Yes,
my name is Michael Krause. I've lived in Yellow Springs since 1963, even longer than my friend Al Schluter. I don't feel safe here. My house was burgled by a drug addict. My identity was stolen at a cost of $50,000 to the banks and others by a drug addict. I lost my son to a drug addict. I think we ought to do everything that we can to get drugs, a cancer, a scourge, out of our community and keep them from being brought here. It has been really eye-opening for me tonight to listen to the young lady, the first one who spoke about the prevalence of heroin in this community. My son was addicted to everything but heroin, and he died. Not of a drug overdose, but his life was ruined by his involvement with drugs. He was a felon. He spent time in the Greene County Jail, in the workhouse in Dayton, in a recovery facility in Cincinnati. He stole his mother's checkbook and forged checks in order to buy drugs. Drugs are a scourge, and we need to do everything we can to keep them out of Yellow Springs.
Thank you, sir. Just don't forget to state your name.
My name is Essence. First of all, good evening to all of you. Thank you for listening. I don't understand how you can say black and black crime and not speak on anything else, like white and white crime, for example. You have countless white children blowing up schools, churches, movie theaters, everything. And for you all to listen and feed into the system, it's oppression, it's racism, it's supremacy at its finest. You have to understand that this system was built to keep us down, to separate riots. And you guys are encouraging that. You're the village council. Last time we met, everyone but one person that spoke said they didn't want to be a part of it. You need to reflect the views of your community. Listen to them. This system has failed. The war on drugs has failed. If you want to help these people, get them help. Don't send them somewhere where they're going to be locked up, itching for more. Help the people.
Thank you. I'm going to hear from Lincoln, and then I'm going to shut down the public comment.
All right. My name is Carter Collins. I lived in the community for 13 plus years. My parents are both involved with the public service in the town. My sort of thoughts on this whole situation comes mainly that, in my views of addiction, it comes from isolation. So if you're putting people in cells and you're making people informants for this ACE task force, you're isolating them further. That's just going to create, you know, further want for that addiction. It's going to feed into it more. I think more money should be spent on funding for treatment, not for funding the ACE task force with a full-time officer from our community. I think that if we take away this demand, the supply is going to diminish. People aren't going to want to sell here if there's no demand for it, if people are being treated. And in that case, I think the ACE task force simply targets the working class and minority communities, and it doesn't target the drug dealers in the end. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay.
First, I want to say thank you to everybody who has spoken so far on all sides of this debate. Did I introduce myself already?
No.
Sorry, I'm Lincoln Alpern. I oppose continued participation in the task force for moral reasons, racism, white supremacy, classism, and also for pragmatic reasons of ineffectiveness at combating drug trafficking and drug abuse. I agree with Councilperson McQueen that we're probably not going to convince anybody either way in this debate. Also that whether or not Yellow Springs remains in the task force, clearly, even if you think that's a good thing, it's not enough. Even our chief of police has said that policing is not going to solve the problem of drug trafficking in Yellow Springs. And there are communities out there, large and small, in this country, other countries, which have faced crisis level problems of drug trafficking, drug abuse, and drug related crimes in their communities, and have found creative ways to solve them. And it sounds to me like Yellow Springs needs to make that commitment, regardless of what decision is made with the drug trafficking force. And I want to speak on issues of safety and fear for just a second. First of all, none of us is completely safe. That's just not a thing. It's danger. That's part of the human condition. And a lot of people in this country, especially white, middle, and upper class, are kind of taught to revere safety, but that is largely illusion. And people who are not white and sort of upper class tend to be not safe regardless in this country. That's something we have to confront. There's a lot of fear that has been deliberately heightened in the drug war since the beginning, and in the country, especially since 9/11, it's really taken off. And there are reasons to be afraid, but we need to meet fear with courage. We have to be courageous.
Thank you. Okay, I'm going to bring it back for us to kind of decide next steps. Something I do want to say is, we are elected officials to represent 3,500 people, not just people that come to meetings, and we hear from other people that you aren't all hearing from. It is also our responsibility to listen to our professional staff that we hire to make decisions and that I hope we trust to advise us in those decisions. We obviously listen to the community. I think this evidence, all of the time we've spent on this is evidence, but I don't want the discussion we've had and the time we've spent on this to be diminished. I think we're trying to hear as much as we can, and we're trying to make responsible decisions.
Karen, can I say something?
Sure.
You know, we've said in a lot of the discussions that we may have, we talk in terms of what I'm hearing is, let's take our money and use it to help those that are addicted, okay, which is fine. But what it also says is, the guy that's out there selling it, keep selling it, because we're going to take care of you. We're going to take care of the addicts and so forth. Okay. The task force to me is not, you know, perfect. You know,
it may not be the solution, but somehow, and I've lived here not quite as long as Al, but I've lived here a long time, and it's been kind of a cycle. Drugs were up, drugs were down, drugs were up, drugs were down. But now we have a serious drug that is up. And I respect the chief and I respect our officers, but our officers are not equipped to handle, at least in my opinion, the seriousness of the drug problem we have. Our officers carry what, a Glock around? Drug dealers ain't carrying a Glock. They're carrying enough to wipe out this whole room. That's how serious a drug dealer is when he's selling the drugs. Okay? We've got a huge area right behind us called the Glen. You know, granted, the lady that spoke says she sees it out of her window, but who sees it in the Glen? Okay? As the chief said, we had a bad incident and we lost a young man in the community. The young man, but he happened to be dealing with drugs. Okay? When my grandson, who is 18, can come home and tell me about the activity that goes on in the Glen, and also where he can buy drugs of any type right here within our walking distance, our police officers can't handle that problem walking around with a badge, their name and so forth. You know, it's not gonna happen. So yes, I'm pushing for us to stay in the task force for two reasons. One, we have grades 1 through 6, and then we have the high school. If that person in sixth grade happens to be approached by a drug dealer and says, hey, here's a piece of candy in a capsule, which it does happen, and he takes it, so he gives him a bag more, and he passes them around, okay? We have a serious problem with drugs. And why the room is filled with those that are opposed to the task force, the people that I've talked to said, they're not going to come down to a council meeting and take that stand. Number one, they say they're intimidated by the people in the room, and also they're fearful of the fact that they're on Channel 5, that someone might come and take them out. Yeah, and you may laugh about this, but this is an older retirement community that have fears that the young folks don't have. And those are the people that I'm listening to that now are arming themselves for protection. So, you know, say what you want, laugh or whatever, you know. We are an older community. We've been through a lot more than the younger folks, and we feel we need protection. And that's the group of people that I'm standing up for.
Anybody else? Council's talking now. We're not taking comments right now.
Well, first of all, I feel very grateful for everyone that's come, and I hear that some people feel like council should have already made this decision, but as some other council people said, this is a room of however many people are here, It's not the whole community. And this is a serious decision, but I really appreciate everything that everyone has said tonight. And clearly it's been difficult, especially for Elizabeth and Jasmine, who are in a minority, and Richard. I think it's been a fairly deep discussion. Also, we really have some different populations in this community. I always feel safe. I've never felt unsafe. I usually don't lock my doors. And I'm older, and I'm white. And I've never seen a drug deal happen. Never, ever. So clearly, we have a lot of different, and Jerry, I mean, I'm shocked that there are people who are arming themselves in this community because they don't feel safe. Clearly, we have some real different experiences going on in this community, and we aren't, I mean, we're finding out about them right here. Also, whether or not we stay in the drug task force, it's not doing what we want. I mean, if we're really serious about dealing with drug abuse and the criminality that comes with it, then we have to take responsibility that we can't just shove off onto the drug task force, whether we stay in it or whether we not.
That's what I have to say right here.
Well, I do want to say I really think Karen articulated well, and it's been said by many people that, again, and I mean, anyone that's been to a council meeting knows that there is always going to be a group that's got a strong position, and that's what we're going to hear. And when we make decisions, we have to think about beyond what we're just hearing from a small group of individuals in this room. That being said, I guess my first thought is, and it kind of follows what Lindsay said about being logical, because that is one aspect of the decision that I'm going to make. I think the assumptions that the task force has never done anything good don't make sense to me. I think the idea that the task force is going to be our savior also doesn't make sense to me. So those arguments I just don't find really all that compelling for this decision. And it kind of does come back to thinking sort of locally what we need to look at. So I am thinking logically. I think all council members are. And so in terms of cost-benefit analysis and just what it gives us and what it takes away, that's important to me. But also, I'm not going to shy away from the value decision in this either. And I do think a lot of people in our community are ambivalent. I don't mean that they don't care, but that it's very hard to sort of, you know, the pros and the cons on this decision. And I think that's why we don't hear from a lot of those people, because we've sort of been tasked with making this decision with a lot of great input. But I do think that a slight majority has probably come out and spoken on this topic, so that influences me as well. I again appreciate the comments, but the idea that this council is feeding into the system is completely opposite. We have spent a lot of time on this issue. We've obviously recognized it as a priority to the community, and so we are going to make a decision. I think it's going to be a good one, and it's not going to make everybody happy, but we certainly are not feeding into the system.
Okay. Well, I also want to just express my appreciation. I really value all the voices that I've heard tonight. And I like the fact that they make making a decision in some ways harder, because there's real passion and there's real lives at stake. So I hear that and I honor it. And it's always, when there is danger in a community, trying to figure out, well, how do we respond to that danger? It can feel like you're making yourself less vulnerable by buying a gun and having it in your house. But actually, there's a lot of studies that say, well, if you actually have that gun in your house,
you're at a greater risk for suicide, you're at a greater risk for a kid picking it up and killing someone, you're at a greater risk. By trying to make yourself feel safer, you've actually undermined your safety. And it's hard for people to get these things that are somewhat counterintuitive. So when I look at this particular issue, if we are in the task force goes on. If we're not in the task force goes on, right? So we aren't making a decision tonight whether to end the task force and end militarization. We're making a decision about what is our participation in the task force going to be. I hear the chief's argument and the arguments of people who have talked to me about it, that the idea is basically to try to combat the kind of organized crime elements that are largely associated with drugs but also associated with other things in our community. And as I said, the task force will go on, and I think it would, any large drug dealer is affecting the whole county. My biggest problem is in many ways with a few things about the way the task force operates. I am concerned about it being this kind of quasi-private, quasi-public entity. It's just very discomforting to me. That there should be a sort of a private board saying pay or play, and yet in its mission statement saying we serve the county. I feel discomforted by just that structural issue. I feel very discomforted by that. I also feel discomforted by forfeiture. I've always felt discomforted by the presence of furtherance of justice funds, and I felt that Cheryl Smith spoke to this quite eloquently. I get the logic, and again, on its face, it makes sense. You've got somebody who's making a lot of, who might be making money off illegal activity, and you don't want people to profit from criminality. But it's so hard to draw lines. Sometimes it's the person with the legitimate job that actually contributed a big part of the car that they're using, and now that person with the legitimate job loses their car because somebody else in the family was taking the car and using it for drugs. So I have never felt comfortable with forfeiture. I'm not comfortable with the idea that even if you're trying not to have it incentivize arrest and police, it's hard to not be looking for money. And there's been some real abuses across the country of civil forfeiture funds. Especially the means by which people get the civil forfeiture funds. And as I said earlier, I'm also uncomfortable with some of the with the what undercover work and the kind of mentality that it seems to put police officers in. Those are the things, and I also should have maybe started with this. In the letter I wrote to, I send an email every week, that I do take as a given that we live in a white supremacist society, right? That our whole geography is shaped by that. I think it can be counterproductive to try, I also get the history of policing that a lot of people have raised here, and that's got its own particular history. But the police are really a reflection of who we are, and our policymakers are the ones often creating these laws that then the police have to uphold. So I try not to scapegoat the police for structural issues, because sometimes, especially white progressives, can feel like we're doing something about racism by
basically yelling it on and blaming it all on the police, then we don't have to work on our own selves, and we don't have to work on who we are and what we're doing. We can just be yelling at the police. So especially for people who look like me, I sometimes feel like it's counterproductive, the narratives that develop around police. And of course, that doesn't mean that police should just be left off the hook for racist acts. In the meantime, we have to continue working on that with the police. But I think we need to keep a lot of our energy targeted on policymakers, particularly at the state and federal level. Police are required to support the laws that our policymakers pass. We can't ask them to ignore or flout laws that would be a violation of their oaths. So that's where I start from, and that's why I am opposed to having an officer in the task force, and also the issue of proportionality is disturbing to me.
Thanks. I'm not going to say a lot. My fellow council members have done a great job of articulating a lot of my thoughts, and I appreciate things that people have said here. And hearing from the citizens and the varied opinions. The fear that I have is for our kids. You know, when I hear about drug deals, as quick, as easy as it is, I live on the bike trail. And so that is, I'm sure that is a ready area and an easy area of access for kids. So that worries the heck out of me. That younger generation, you know, there are things we talked about with Dr. Hallie of, you know, education, making sure that we have education in the schools. It sounds like maybe, I was a little surprised to hear him say, yeah, we're back in the Yellow Springs schools. It's disappointing that they were out of the Yellow Springs schools. So, you know, what I feel we haven't really talked about is what are our solutions if we do get out of the task force. You know, we've had a lot of great ideas. Where do we go from here? I don't know, council, are we ready? I could be ready to take, but this is my feeling. I am leaning towards voting to exit the task force. What I would like to do, though, is to take a little bit of time to develop an exit strategy of how that happens, next steps, what can we do with TCN, what can we do with our funds? What does that, what does the police department look like if we do that? How does potentially annexing the Glen impact that? You know, what is our manpower? How, I want to talk to people I know at Green County commissioners and the sheriff about, you know, how we can make sure that the entire county is being adequately covered with in situations like this. So I feel like I still have a lot of, I feel like we don't have a lot of solutions, but we have, for me, I think that, you know, hearing from the community, the financial piece of it, I will not be party to, I will not agree to writing a resolution or to our exit strategy be for repudiating the task force or our police department or our involvement as unlawful or as militaristic. That's one thing I won't support. It's another thing I'd like to do is figure out how we're going to craft what kind of a resolution and what kind of a exit strategy we'd like to craft.
Take a vote?
Well, me, you know, I'm not ready to vote.
You're not ready to vote? I mean,
why? You ready?
Yeah.
I'm talking to Karen. I don't care. I'm not ready to vote yet because I have not heard from, I've heard from one half of one side of Yellow Springs. I haven't had a chance to get to the other side. And as I said, there are a lot of people out there that maybe what Brian called, they're saying stay in the task force. So, but I feel that I would be ready by our next meeting.
So So do we want, so based upon, I mean, do we want to put together, does HRC have a meeting? I mean, I wouldn't mind having, you know, what can we do about, you know, are there any treatment, is there a way to get TCN over here for a day? How could we facilitate that?
It seems like we need to create something and we don't exactly know what it is. And maybe there are some communities that, as has been mentioned, that have done some things that would make sense to look into. But then maybe we need a sort of a steering committee that'll do that, but that connect, I mean, because it's not just about treatment. I think we need to think about the criminality,
right?
Prevention, treatment, and crimes and safety.
What I would say, though, is I don't really think that we're going to gain much by having another public forum where we're discussing all these issues over again, where we're trying to have this conversation again. I just have my doubts that different people are going to show up. So I guess I would suggest that we take a vote. It's not a resolution, it's not even an ordinance, but we take a vote about the task force so that people know where we stand and what we decided. And then these next steps have to come after that.
Well, I do agree that the solution piece is separate from this decision, but I feel that if a council member says that they're looking for more information and they're ready by the next meeting, that I want to respect that. So
Jerry, you're wanting, is there anything, so staff is prepared, is there anything you're wanting from staff or you're wanting to hear from citizens?
I want to hear from the citizens. If I had my choice, I think we should go to a vote.
Yeah. A vote of the citizens?
Put it on and let all the citizens vote, say either one is in the task force or not. But I also have to respect the fact that what Brian said, we were elected to make and set policy.
Yeah.
And to me, I want to hear from more people. I've heard a lot from the groups that oppose it, okay? But the folks that want to keep us, want to keep, as I said before, they're not going to put their names up. So, yeah, when you're going to find out, it's my problem.
Well, I mean, like I said in my piece, I guess.
Chris, do you want to?
Yes, if I could.
Make sure everybody knows who you are.
Chris Conard, I'm the village solicitor. Ordinarily, I wouldn't address council on something that's really a matter of policy, and certainly nothing I'm saying now is intended to persuade any member of council or the community one way or another. I'm simply trying to come up with a methodology to help council work their way through this. I was a public defender for 11 years, was deputy director of the office in Montgomery County, and as in that role, I went to a number of national symposium seminars where issues like this were discussed because of, we've been having this debate for generations now. And I think Talis said something really interesting, which was, there is a community component here, that's what I've heard. And there are other communities like the village that have dealt with that. The chief has probably been to some of those national discussions and at the state level as well. We heard that there are villagers who see what appears to be somewhat open and notorious drug traffic. What I didn't hear is there a methodology within the village that says there's a means to report what they see in some way that will provide some assurances of safety? What you have in these discussions is a community coming together that says we want to work towards a common goal and a broader goal. And I think that Karen, you addressed that as well, which is there's not a solution at the end. And I'm not sure there's a finite solution, a definitive one, but is there some balance of this? You also mentioned that at some point I would expect that you're going to ask me to draft a resolution. While it's not clear where this vote is going to go, I suspect I'm going to have to draft one that says we stay in, the village stays in, and the village steps out. The language of that resolution is going to be something that's going to be discussed too. So what I'm hearing is that at some point council is going to ask me to draft a resolution. That can be done at the next meeting. That will give some time to look into these issues that some members of council have expressed an interest in finding out about. And that might be a way to not button this down, but to get some more concrete resolution to the discussion rather than today, because it sounds to me as if there's some open ends to that.
Right. So I think I heard Chris suggesting that perhaps the solution is that we actually write a resolution, have a resolution brought to the next meeting that
for each way.
Either for each way or to is or for, I don't see where we would necessarily need to have one. I would say the resolution would be to come out of the task force,
yeah.
And obviously we either vote it up or down.
Yeah, that's it. That's it. We don't need a separate stay in resolution.
And then that gives us time. We, you know, that still gives us time to hear from people. I would, you know, there are things, and these are things that I can share with Patty. There are things that have been brought up that I would like to understand. You know, what happens if there are ongoing cases and things like that. And so, you know, there are things that perhaps council can individually share with Patty that they would like to have answers to. I think probably the treatment piece is certainly important and something that I would like perhaps HRC to kind of pursue or look at. Catherine's here from NAMI. I don't know if NAMI has a role in that at all, but definitely something I would like to see us pursue and how we could help that, at least encourage it. I liked what Chris said about, you know, do we have a system set up for anonymous reporting. So does anybody have any suggestions of the language, or should we just let Chris wing the language in the resolution?
I would be ready to vote on the resolution at the next meeting. And I agree with you, it should be that you leave a task force and then we go.
Chris could maybe, I don't know, Marianne or I don't care. I would be happy to look at it in advance.
Both of us, maybe.
Okay.
Okay. I will do that.
Great.
Thank you all. Thank you for.
Thank you. Oh, and we have to keep this door open, so if you want to have conversations, that's lovely, but try to do it downstairs, because we have to keep going.
The next discussion is about the Glen Helen annexation. I mentioned it to Nick. I'm not sure, although at this point I'm not sure if there's anything that he can add. I think the reason we added it to the agenda is that we would like to move it along. It's really in our court to come up with to approve a pre-annexation agreement.
Right.
And what I wanted to talk about was I've heard people expressing concerns. Kate expressed concerns about that decision adding to the budget. What I heard from Chief and Patty is that they didn't think that would. So I guess I want to just open it up to Patty and Chief to again kind of talk to us about what operationally that decision would mean for the village.
Right, and I actually wrote that down when Kate mentioned it, because we do not believe that there will be any increase whatsoever in the budget, and that is not contingent upon whether we do or do not stay in the task force. The only concern that even I expressed to Chief about the potential manpower impact was, should there be a search for someone who was lost, in which case we'd have volunteers coming out of the woodwork anyway. But as far as the chief, I believe, did some research on the number of calls that the sheriff's department has had over in that area. So, Chief, do you want to address that?
It's predominantly the building of the police department that when we initially take it over, there'd probably be a larger volume of calls, but after a month or two, that would level out and they would be pretty insignificant. We predominantly put two officers out, 7 in the morning till 3 in the morning, and believe we can handle that current staffing.
But when you say put two officers out, you mean on patrol, you don't
yes.
mean in the Glen?
In the village itself, which if the Glen becomes part of the village, although one of the officers would clearly go there more often to check, you know, we don't expect the kind of calls that just is going to be very, very time consuming. There's, you know, get a whole lot of burglaries, you know, it's letting people know there's rules and those rules will be enforced.
Are you saying that you checked with the calls that come from the Glen to the sheriff's department and that there really aren't that many calls? Is that what you're saying?
Yeah, there really is not that large of a number. I spoke with Sergeant Knapp about it just from a historical standpoint. A lot of those calls we already respond on because sometimes the sheriff's office is 8, 10, 12 minutes off. There's a lady that works for Antioch that actually goes into the Glen. She's out there with somebody who maybe has an open container. We don't let her hang. We send an officer anyway. We don't have the jurisdictional authority to do anything except maybe keep that situation from getting worse. So we're there for a while. A deputy will show up. We leave the scene. So we're already responding for the most part.
Has the Glen indicated any possibility that they would perhaps increase their rangers? I mean, I know they have one full-time now.
They just took her from part-time to full-time.
Okay.
So I don't think that I don't believe they have any plans.
I am not aware of any plans.
Are there other village services that might be impacted? Like, one of the things I think about is zoning. I mean, I know that that's a small thing, but a lot of these properties, a lot of the new properties at the Glen actually have projects. Even though it just went into a conservation easement, they're doing a lot of projects, they're doing a lot of facilities renovations. I want to make sure that, you know, we're involved in whatever permitting and that whole process is, we're able to handle all that.
Yeah, I think one of Jerry's concerns that he brought up during the forum had to do with the utilities and should they be extended. The Glen does not intend to, they have utilities already at their facilities. They don't intend to expand the utilities in greater distance. If they build something near an existing structure that already has utilities, would they likely extend to that new structure? Yes. But as far as extending a great amount back into the Glen, that is not in the plan at all. As far as the zoning, once it's in the village, it's in the village. So yes, our zoning would apply to any projects that they would have.
And they would take any building project through us to start with,
just like they do at Antioch.
Yeah. We just need to figure out. I mean, we could just zone it. College,
right?
Yeah, I think it's going to come in as conservation.
It's going to come in as I believe RC, but you need to immediately rezone it to whatever council. Besides, it should be, everything comes in at a set zone when you annex, and then you have to change it. And I believe under our code, it comes in as RC, and you just change it. It comes in as something specific. If that's not what you want it to be, the next ordinance is that you change it.
I don't think we want it to be RC.
Right.
Yeah. So. I don't think, it probably doesn't matter since it's conservative.
Right. But that's why, because there's educational stuff, that's why they just started educational.
Yeah, I think we'll just kind of look and figure that out. So Chris, could you answer, what is the ball in our court now, or is there something else that has to happen from there and?
The answer is kind of. I had spoken with Nick, and we were kind of waiting for this. Obviously, you're not voting to approve anything, but a clear indication from council, yes, let's move forward. There's a technical piece that Nick is going to have to arrange. It's a very detailed legal descriptions that are requirements for Greene County. I really don't want to move forward until I know those are done, because we get on a timeline. Nick has spoken to the trustees, and I believe that the commissioners are on board. So I don't anticipate there's going to be any mechanical issues, but there is a tight timeline once certain events happen. And so we want to make sure that on the front end we're correct before the village enters into the pre-annexation agreement.
So we shouldn't even do the pre-annexation agreement. That's what kicks off this schedule?
Yes, and Nick knows that. I've spoken with him, and now with the guidance that I've received today, I can work with Nick to get the legal descriptions drafted in a way that, again, the county is very specific about what needs to be presented to them.
So, council, are we comfortable directing that process to move forward?
I am.
Yeah. Okay. Good. Okay. Thank you. We have no new business. Next, the manager's report.
Let's see here. GM line is just about finishing up down on Xenia. Coffee with a cop. We had a good number of people show up. You have some pictures in your packet showing the chief at the Spirited Goat, Officer Knapp at Dino's, and Officer Meister at Emporium. And we had quite a few people show up. Some of them went to each of the three places. We hope for the next event to be a morning event, so that the folks who don't want to come in the evening can maybe speak to an officer in the morning, stop by, you know, on their way to work or something. So we are planning on having many more of these. But Chief, do you want to? I mean, I was going back and forth amongst all three of them. The chief was at the goat, having a good conversation there.
Yeah, I mean, it was enjoyable. I think there was a lot of questions, a lot of things answered. It gave the citizens that showed up an opportunity to talk one-on-one or two-on-one to an officer. Really went a whole lot off limits. And so seems like all the officers spoke the entire hour and a half here there and had a little trouble drinking their tea or cider for me, since I don't drink the coffee, so.
I heard very positive responses from, and I think it's just that outreach to perhaps the unexpected person that, you know, wouldn't normally feel comfortable talking to you all, so I think that's great.
Right. And besides the different times, are we also gonna have the different officers? Mm-hmm. Okay, so I wanna make sure that all the officers in that rotation.
Right, we want to have three different officers each time.
Okay, great.
The levy, we talked briefly a few months back about the survey through CUPA, and council, now that we're moving more towards the levy, council will need to make a decision on that. I did get an email from Carol at Wright State wanting to know if we were going to proceed with that or not.
I would say at this point we don't really have enough time. I think that discussion was, you know, are we going to change the levy? Are we going to add sidewalks? I think that, okay. I don't think we need to do it.
Right, I think it's something that if something bad happens in March, then we should revisit that.
Yes.
But I think the message is out there that it's important for the running of the village, the successful running of the village, so.
One thing that I know this has come before council with my predecessor, and that was speaking to council about potentially raising the spending limit for the village manager. Currently the state spending limit is $50,000. Ours here is $15,000. I'm not asking council to raise it to $50,000, but there are several things that could easily be impacted. In fact, if I can find the correct pile of papers, I did ask Jason, Johnny, and Brad to give me some lists of things that could potentially cost well more than the $15,000 if they were to go wrong. Brad's list has to do with motors and pumps and screen brakes and RAS and RAS pumps at the lift stations and things in the water plant, filter beds. Those are easily more than that. Johnny has regulators at the switching station, transformers for large clients, and major main breaks where he needs to call in a contractor for assistance. And Jason did not send me a list.
What do you think would be a reasonable, like, $25,000?
I would say at least $25,000, yes. I mean, that would give me substantially more leeway without invoking the emergency clause that is in the charter. So
how about we go to 30?
Double 30 would make, I wouldn't have a problem with 30.
The state limit?
The state limit is 50. Okay.
Have you talked with other managers or?
Most municipalities just make it whatever the state limit is. And that about 4 or 5 years ago went from 25 to 50.
Yeah.
But most municipalities are not chartered municipalities.
Right. Because to me, I think she should have this, you know, what the state limit is. And I think she would have the sense, you know, if something is that amount that, you know, she's just not going to arbitrarily go out and do it. You know, it's going to be some discussion with it. You know, I just feel she should have a 50. Now, I guess the question is, if we say 50, is it cop launch or giving you,
I can assure you that absent an emergency, I would not spend that amount of money without coming to council.
Right,
anyway.
That's what I.
There are things that could go to that in an emergency, but.
Right, but, in most cases when you have them.
So if there was an emergency and there was a big expense right now, and it really needed to be fixed like right now, we have to call a special session.
There's an emergency clause in the, it's either in the charter or in the village ordinance, I can't remember which, that allows me to exceed my spending limit for an emergency. And then it's a five council.
So if there's that clause that handles emergencies, what's the,
well, for instance, if two pumps go down at the sewer plant,
and it's not quite an emergency or something,
right? They're easily $10,000 a piece,
right?
But I guess the 50, getting all the way to the 50,
I'm comfortable with the 30. I appreciate Jerry's input and his confidence.
I do too. I think it's just that sense that.
We've had
managers before that I haven't had quite as much confidence in. So we're not ruling just for Patty, we're ruling for anybody who might be in that seat. And ideally that doesn't happen, right? Ideally you have confidence in your manager, but there are times when you don't. And so I guess we're a smaller budget than a lot of municipalities. So I think 30,000.
Yeah, so just bring that resolution to the next meeting.
Yes.
And the last thing that I have
I think it needs to be an ordinance because I think we're going to be amending the ordinance.
Yeah.
So.
Okay. The last thing I have is I just want everybody to know that Greene County Park District is going to start cutting down those dead and diseased elm trees. So
ash trees.
Or ash trees, I mean. And, I actually, when I was walking on them, on Saturday morning or Sunday morning, there was a tree down all the way across the bike path, and I had to call them in, they had to come in. You'll see them marked with a big white X. They're all throughout the county. There are quite a few along the trail, especially south towards Xenia, where I've been walking a lot lately. But they are going to start cutting those down, so please don't be horribly upset when you see them start falling, because they are dead or dying, and there's not a very good treatment for the Emerald Ash Borer. And finally, as Brian noted earlier, I will be leaving on Thursday, early Thursday morning, flying out to do the 3-day 60-mile walk in San Diego. I will be back into town late Monday. However, I will not be back in the office until the 30th. I leave the village in Melissa's capable hands while I spend the holidays with my family.
That's great. Will you be sending reports or anything?
I will be making regular posts on Facebook.
I mean about your walk.
Yeah. Yes. However, you do need to know that they have very specific safety rules on this walk, and you are not allowed to pull your phone out while you're on the course without moving completely off the course, or they will kick you out. So I may not do a lot of it, except when I stop it for a break or something. And as Melissa is not here tonight, if you have any questions about her report, I will do my best to answer them.
Judy? Just that it's been very busy, and you have we actually picked up a couple more clerks, so 28 clerks will be here on Friday for a training. And they're all been pretty excited about visiting the village. So we hope they will come and purchase things and do other things besides taking training.
What's the total number?
28.
So we're having the swearing in on the 21st.
Correct. Yes.
Excellent. But they still won't take office.
Don't take office.
And it's not effective until.
Okay,
so is somebody going to read off boards and commissions?
Well, I just have one that I think you guys should hear, and that was on planning. And that was with Nora. On the breakfast, and we had a turnout just like we had tonight for that. And there was a.
Are you guys paying attention?
Yes, sorry.
Yes. Okay. There was a lot of support for Nora. A number of people spit out, and I think it was Matt.
Matt Ray.
I mean, he really did a good job. Allow everyone in the audience to express their opinion. There was a little bit of lack of misunderstanding in terms of what actions planning was asking us to go to make, and that kind of calmed folks' nerves, okay? But we didn't. Approved her request for conditional use with the following conditions. The use is limited to 40 persons on 1 day a week. Okay? Parking would be accommodated through Town Market. She had a letter from Town, and also from Corner Cone. How folks use their parking. The space was approved based on the fact that the limited use is for 4 hours per week. Okay. There can be a maximum of one volunteer and any family member to serve as assistants.
Nora, one volunteer to help, and
40 people.
Any
family member can also serve as an assistant. So she only has one volunteer. You know, she says she's going to have volunteers coming in at one.
And why only one? Or, I mean, is that because of the code we already have? Or?
Right. So, yeah. And then the final one, any state or county regulations must be. And there was further discussion on how she should go about changing the 40 people and so forth. And planning is going to look that up. But they did, Matt did explain to her that when you go for that increase, and the people that are living in the polls are going to start coming out, because she would then be in competition with some of the restaurants and so forth in town. So, and she understood that. Her fear was that she wouldn't want to make it anything. And, no, she can't. So.
Okay. So that's all that you have. So we'll move to. Do you have any?
I don't have any.
So we'll move to Mary Ann.
Okay, so the Environmental Commission is basically talking about a number of different topics. There's no decision about anything, but working on the wellhead plan, talking about an ordinance that would allow native plantings on lawns and make some possible changes to some of the regulations about lawn, talking about rain gardens and supporting rain gardens as a possibility for as an option for containing water on one's property. Well, we continue to talk. We interact with the Climate Action Plan group, but no decision about it. The HRC, there was a discussion about the website for the help, yellowspringshelp.org, that has sort of stalled, well, not sort of, has stalled. Mm-hmm. Apparently there's been a fair amount of money put into it, but the Antioch student that was working on it got sick, and no one has really done much, so there was a discussion about how to move that forward with no resolution at this point. There were several, I think three requests for funds. One was approved for African dance group. One was sent back for reconsideration. And I think something that came out of the discussions about the grants was that there aren't really guidelines, there aren't internal guidelines within HRC for how to decide about grants. So that's something I think that HRC will be working on at its planning, its annual planning. And I did not go, I was out of town, I was kayaking in the Pinocchi Swamp for the Energy Board meeting.
Right.
Yes, I was at the Energy Board meeting. And yeah, I mean, the Energy Board meeting, great discussion. Primarily the focus is, was on, some of the priorities moving forward. I don't think there was anything all that new. I mean, it was a sort of a discussion of some of the what are some of the things that the commission's going to look forward to in 2016. And there was definitely some interest in, we had talked about commissions that might want funding for activities. So that was discussed in terms of what some of the Energy Board's needs might be. Arts and Culture Commission, I already mentioned about VITA, and we are now taking nominations for the spring VITA, or I'm sorry, the winter VITA. So that'll be the next one coming up. And otherwise, mostly talking about goals. One of the things, and I guess this came from the HRC, there was also a grant for an artist who's doing a pretty interesting project about raising awareness about mental illness, and she wants that to be an education piece here in the gallery. So now that we have the, I think, more clear public art policy, we're definitely looking at how can we start getting art back in the Bryan Center.
The community access panel, the station's going great. You probably saw Susan's report. She keeps on doing fun stuff. Thank you, Susan. And we focused a lot on just kind of talking about what sort of technological needs there are for the station. There are a few items that have gotten pretty old that we probably need to replace, and Susan and Melissa are handling that. The other piece is SpringsNet is planning to bring to council before the end of the year their white paper on how the municipal broadband would work. So the idea is they want to put that report together, also making sure that Judith gets a copy of that, and have a short presentation to kind of gear up for next year and looking at whether that's something that we want to move forward with. They're working with Melissa, they're working with Patty, they're working with Johnny, which I think is really important that it's vetted on the village and village staff in before it comes to council.
Sounds good. Chamber, we're in nomination time for new board members, and so far we have actually three potential new board members, that two new business owners, which is exciting. To welcome new people on board. Those elections will happen in December. The chamber, I know that a few months ago that there was a discussion at council that Patty brought about adding pavers around the trees. Mm-hmm. Through a lot of discussions with Nadia Malarkey and Bob Moore and other experts that felt that the pavers were not a good idea because it was too compacting, and that the tree roots were already too close to the surface, and that digging down with the pavers would be kind of disastrous. So the chamber actually did hire Bob Moore to go in and loosen up the dirt. He remulched it and he put in daffodil bulbs. So we might see some color. So we're kind of looking at the idea of having color year round. Doing some plantings. The thought being from Bob and Nadia that if there are flowers in the beds, that people won't step in them, that maybe they'll be more careful. We'll experiment and see what happens. But he also said he would like to talk to the staff about the kind of the content of the soil, the makeup of the soil in the new beds, so we could kind of coordinate that too. And let's see what else. MVRPC, we actually passed the regional bike plan, which was exciting. It's an incredible piece of work, so a lot of time, a lot of energy went into that. I put the minutes in the packet, and their planning staff, Martin Kim, who's been here I think at least once, and their planning staff, after all the Going Places work, are really starting to reach out and taking the tools that they've developed and the recommendations that they've developed and going to communities and offering services. Like, you know, they're willing to help us with GIS and provide GIS services. So I've connected him and Denise so that we can start to take advantage of some of the services that they're providing. So I think that's it. We are still not done because I'd like a motion to go into executive session for the purpose of discussion of matters required to be kept confidential by federal law or regulations or state statutes.
Do you also have personnel matters to see?
Oh, we do yes. have personnel matters yes. to discuss, yes.
So
second.
Actually, it's not personnel matters, it's litigation.
Litigation.
Yeah, so litigation or the threat of litigation.
Okay. No, but the personnel matters is
separate.
Oh, okay. I'm sorry. All right.
You can't just say personnel. You have to be specific. You say review of the village manager.
Do I stop? Yeah. Do I stop?
Now we're done. Yeah.
Yes.
You know,
Esland. Yes.
Sims.
Yes.
Hush.
Yes.
McQueen.
Yeah.